Welcome, everybody. Well, we can, I'll do some question and answer first. If you got anything, I take it this is deliverance training, so I take it that you're all going beyond your personal deliverance and you're helping other people get free. So that's what this class is based for. That's our goal in this class, is to help you help people. Because the minute you get delivered, just like the minute I got saved, not the next minute, but what was birthed in me was I need to get people born again. And everything that I didn't understand, I assume people didn't understand that either. I assumed that I was a Christian. I didn't believe in Muhammad. I didn't believe in Buddha. I didn't go to any New Age cults. I was raised in the Lutheran church. I believed in Jesus and I knew the basic gospel, but I wasn't born again. The minute I was born again, I realized people had been duped and they think that they're born again like I thought I was born again, but wasn't born again. And then once I got healed, man, I was on a mission to pray for people to get healed. The first person I prayed for was not my comfort zone. I could tell they were homosexuals and I didn't care. I could care less what they thought. I saw a bum knee. My knee had literally got healed in the morning and now we were at lunch. I wanted someone to get healed. Well, once I got delivered, I was like, my goodness, man, everyone's got spirits. This makes sense now. Wow, there was something in me that wouldn't stop. Just kept messing with my mind, just kept driving me, enticing me, manipulating me, sidetracking me from one thing to the next thing continually. And in return, I was blinded to what they were doing. And then the blinders come off when you get delivered. Now, I still had a lot more deliverance to go, but I understood the devil was real. Slowly, the devil likes to put you on ice. Welcome. And he likes you to believe that he's not real. Or if you believe that he is real, he wants you to believe that he's not active. Oh, he's active. He's moving. He's moving, and once you have eyes to see, you can see it. And but now we're supposed to be able to do something about it. Well, it's hard to deliver other people. People get into a lot of problems because when you do get saved, you can lead someone to Jesus. You know, because that's not that hard. You proclaim, hey, you got to be born again. Do you have this? Do you have an encounter with Jesus? Do you have the Spirit of God? Do you have a hunger? No. Well, you need to get born again. It's pretty clear. If you get healed and someone's got a bad leg or a bad body part, hey, you can get some people healed if you have faith. But to get people delivered, you got to have some deliverance yourself. Or you're going to get into some trouble. You're going to get some transfer spirits. Those demons are going to say, just like the seven sons of Sceva, they said, hey, we got some violence in here. How about a butt whooping? I mean, when you get beat down naked, that is an official butt whooping. And they whooped them down, saying, hey, we're not listening to you. You don't have the authority. You believe in God, but you don't have the authority over us because you have spirits, right? And so sometimes you'll think you're getting people delivered and you can actually be getting sicker. And then what happens is a lot of people, they go through knowledge of deliverance. Maybe they get a touch of deliverance, but they have so many wounds and so much insecurity and fear that the devil will trick you with deliverance to drive you away from it and say, hey, you'd be good at this. Hey, no one's doing this at your church. You know what? This is your opportunity to be significant and to be special. You should cast out demons. And in return, they don't last long because they haven't done what it takes to get rid of the stuff in your own life. You know, it's not a prerequisite that everybody in your family is delivered before you get people delivered. It's not prerequisite that you get all your spirits out, because as you go, you find out, wow, there's still some stuff in there. You didn't know. You assumed that you were free. That's all it takes to help somebody. But, you know, we've seen people here that want to go from A to Z. They want to go from a couple rounds of deliverance to be in the deliverance minister. And in return, the demons are running it. And some of them were on YouTube for a while. And the demons were literally running their deliverance ministry. It was a dog and pony show. And so you have to get rid of your insecurities and fears. You have to get rid of the fact that in this world, a lot of us were insignificant in the church of God. We weren't preachers. We weren't pastors and leaders. And in return, you know, God is raising you up. But that's when you're humble. You have to be humble and you have to be able to hear God. You got to be able to understand the moving of the Spirit and how He's raising you up. That's important. Because the minute the devil gets an opportunity, he'll push you forward faster than you're able to endure, you know, or a level that you can't endure the storm, the floods, and the beating. Because he will beat on you. He will send a flood to you. He will test you. He'll test your finances. He'll test your faith. Once you know it's real, he's going to show you that it's real. It's like, okay, you had a level of this thing being real. Now you're going to experience some more. So I'll open it up to some questions since we have a small group, because at the end, I'm going to just move into the deliverance for ourselves.
Hey, explain that terminology of when somebody becomes too spiritually minded, where they become no earthly good anymore. You know, what the demons do to the religious demons, I think you brought it up a while back about how you get into deliverance, right? And all of a sudden now everything is spiritual, everything's a demon, everything is this, and then now nobody can even have conversations with you. I'm running into people on the right like this.
Well, okay. Well, there's some foundation. His question was, when people go so over the top that everything's so spiritually that they're no earthly good, they can't even make any traction for the things that they're attempting to do. And I got a guy just like that. Sometimes he'll call me 2-3 times a day. And he's literally driving his wife mentally ill. I'm not even kidding. I was like, here's my prayer. Could you leave your wife alone for the day? And he laughs. Because he's trying to fix her with all these things, and he's got a lot of spirits. He is born again. He's seen the spirit move. He's been in here a bunch of times. He wants that to be a part of his life. Those are all good things, but he won't deal with his issues. And so in return, it's just like 24 hours a day, everything spiritual. Paul's the most powerful Christian that ever walked the planet, bar none. And he was a tent maker. I mean, he's got to go, you know, Jesus took his disciples after these meetings, whether it's the Sermon on the Mount, Sermon in the Plain, preaching by the shore in a ship, and he takes them to the other side. He takes them to the mountain to regroup and to pray. And what'll happen, this devil can burn you out with all these spiritual things. So it's kind of like you can't get a drink off a fire hose. It's too powerful. So he'll turn the fire hose on you. And another scripture is they're forever learning and never coming to the knowledge of the truth. So you have to just go back to the basic foundations, is that God does give you power, but he gives you love. So everything you got to do with this power is initiated off love. And in return, when you operate by these principles of his power and his love flowing through you, your mind is sound. And then the Bible says to do everything decently and in order. You have to be patient. Some things you have to pray, and you got to wait for that door to open. You got to wait for the soil to be a good enough opportunity to plant that seed. They're too hard sometimes, and you got to have patience. You got to have some discernment. And so that's one of the attributes of the Holy Spirit, is he gives the spirit of discernment to discern good from evil. He discerns timing. And so those people can't discern those things because the devil's shooting, he's turning on the fire hose. And so it's splashing off them at a high level. And then in return, I think you can play around with mental illness. You know, when I got born again, you know, I had some conversations with Jesus, some longer than others. And if you tell someone, like I told my mother, talking with Jesus, she didn't say anything at the time, but called her sister, who was a criminal psychologist at the university, or not the university, but the state mental institution of Missouri. And she worked there for years and years. And she called me up and said, Rick, turns the subject, I hear you're talking to God now. And I said, yeah, you know, not every day, but, you know, he speaks to me mostly through his word, but I've heard him a few times. Rick, you know, every inmate here, they all talk to God. And then phase two is they start thinking they're God or one of the prophets, right? And I was like, oh, okay, you know, and kind of got off. I knew they weren't born again. She was raised Catholic and wasn't too committed to that. By the grace of God, how he goes full circle, I was able to pray for her to receive Jesus and have an encounter with Jesus before she died. She was a career lesbian and had multiple diseases, organ transplants, and then ultimately died in her 50s. But God did turn it around. So everything we have to do has to be from the spirit of discernment, which is wisdom and knowledge, how God wants it done, and then the timing and the understanding of how to get it done. And what happens if you have insecurities and you have a bunch of poor self-worth in you, the demons are going to run you and say, now you have significance. Now you have something other people don't know. Now you've experienced something that no one else has experienced. You need to get out there and tell everybody. And they can crack you. And you can go to mental illness, because then you get so out there on your own, because the Holy Spirit didn't lead you out there like that. He's not the one turning on the fire hose, you know, on your face. That's the devil doing it. And then if you listen to the voice of another, you'll fall down that road. The opposite of the sound mind is a mind that's lost. And we've seen it in here. Mike did a great staff meeting of encouragement for us. It's us that's been here for a long time. And one of the encouragements was the people that lost their anointing, the people that lost their hunger for God, that were incredible servants for God, people that had an incredible anointing from God. And then some of them fizzled out. Some of them drifted completely away. And some of them got cracked up with bad doctrines. And offenses is one of the reasons, probably half the time, that people fall away from Holy Ghost ministries, because there's spirits that move around ministries like this. I hate to tell you, we're getting spirits out of people, but they'll come around here and test somebody. I don't know, maybe they'll follow you in the parking lot. They can hear what's going on. I don't know how it works exactly, but there's things that, I mean, there was one time, wasn't many people here. Mike was calling me a couple times a day, telling me about these one-on-ones. And what I realized was he was seeing if I was a person he could invest into. He was seeing if I had the same mind. You know, is this a person that I can go all into? Is this a person I need to back up and give him a little time? Showed all the right signs. Is this person? And then in return, as time progressed, you know, you get busy, I get involved in the ministry, there'd be times I would text and he wouldn't respond for a couple days. I'm like, man, what's wrong with this dude? You know, what do you got, better people than me to answer their text to? You got better investments now? Like, it was just negativity. Well, I was kind of unwise of the schemes of the devil, that he has to attack you when you're bearing good fruit, when you're walking on that thin and narrow road. Those are the people that he wages a war against. He doesn't wage a war against people on the broad road to destruction and the lukewarm. He drove you to the broad road. He drove you to the lukewarm church so you would be ineffective. So he's going to try to challenge you any way he can. And he knows how prone humans are to disappointment, to letdowns, to sense of whatever disrespect or what might be perceived as any of those things. And so he will try to hit you with those. Good question. So people have to learn patience. You have to learn patience. And a deliverance minister, you know, I don't even like that term. Like, my one buddy used to call me that. I was at his church. He was our pastor. And I'm like, I don't like that term, a deliverance minister. I don't see that in the Bible. You know, it's a sign of a believer. Man, I'm trying to win souls. I'm trying to disciple people, equip the saints, trying to use my gift to bring somebody up at another level. So being called a deliverance minister is just not in the Bible. It's just a sign of a believer. So we all have this authority. And God's authority is real. His power is real. And it'll go forth and it'll go into operation when you use it. And so someone, if you're discipling them and you're raising them up and helping them in deliverance, but you don't teach them patience and you don't teach them discernment and you don't teach them how to operate with love and how it works together. When you're in God's love, he'll open those doors. He'll shut doors. He'll tell you when it's time to be quiet. He'll give you some eyes to see what a person can retain, what they can absorb, and what's too much, and he'll even correct you if it's too little. Some people do need to be called out and called to attention. But those are the things that I'd be encouraging people that are suffering from those consequences and or from those symptoms. And YouTube makes it. It creates them. YouTube Christianity has cracked a lot of people. And not to say it's not good ministers, you know. It's why it was very important to be accountable, you know. Some people will tell me when I'm wrong. Some people in this ministry give me some looks. And I was like, oh, man, that I must have said some things. I better think about some things. Ooh, I know what things instantly I was saying that I shouldn't have said, because that's a disappointing look in someone in this ministry. So they are telling me. But we got a hall of fame down there of Deliverance ministers. One of them was Lester Summerall. And I don't know much about him. I know that he started Rod Parsley, and he used to have a lot of 100 churches. He used to give churches away. But I watched the, and I'm not trying to disrespect the guy. I mean, he did some stuff that's undeniable. He did some stuff. I heard he wrote some incredible books. I haven't read them, but I've heard they're written well, and a lot of revelation is in there. But I'm watching this YouTube video, and I'm thinking, okay, hey, man, that look at Rod Parsley, boy. He looks fresh off the, you know, suit rack of, like, he was a model for JCPenney's, man. He was fresh and shiny with his suit. And I said, I'm going to watch this. Lester Summerall, no disrespect to the guy, he started about talking about cursing people. And the first one was someone was going to take his nephew's church away in the Philippines, and the bank realized how much equity and how well they had built that church. It was worth a lot more money, so they took his interest rate from 24% to 48%. He was never late on a payment. Couldn't make the payment. They were going to take it. And he calls up his uncle Lester Summerall, and he goes, what should I do? And he says, I want you to go down there for 6 days, and I want you to go down there with some signs saying, I curse the Bank of China, and I curse every banker to die with cancer. Maybe it was to get cancer, maybe not die with cancer, but it was to get them cancer. And then he bragged about how they repented, and he said, I'll give you the money. And he went and got a bank from America, but I'm not paying you this exorbitant interest. I want you to sign it right now. There's no discussions when he went there, and they did it. And people clapped for it. And I don't see that in the Bible. There was a time when Elymas, I'm not sure if I'm saying his name right, but he was a sorcerer, and he had infiltrated the house of God. He was with the Jews. And when Paul came preaching Christ, he was trying to turn them away from the truth. And so blindness came upon him for 3 days, but then he returned his sight, right? So God was showing the power that this is defeated power. This is the power of the wicked one. And but you don't curse people. Then he goes on, he does it again in the same message. And he owned this property and had all these trees, 300 and some trees. He was going to tear it down to build this big house. And all this environmental activists came around. I was kind of stumped going, man, they were around in the 80s back then? I didn't even know that. And he goes, they said, well, you can't build this because the squirrels aren't going to have any trees to live in, and the rabbits aren't going to have any place to roam. You can't do this. So he goes in there. And he says, hey, I'll tell you what, to the guy that's making the decision, I got a 1,000-member church, and if you don't sign this paper for me to build, I'm going to make a plaque with your name on it. I'm going to give it to 1,000 members of my church, and I'm going to tell them what a low-down, you know, dirty person you are. Then I'm going to curse the finances of everybody on that board that came against it, and I'm going to buy their houses when they go bankrupt. I mean, these are serious curses. This guy's on the Hall of Fame of doing things. I'm not saying that we should take his name off there. I mean, he was doing some stuff. I mean, he was going around to Asia and meeting men, like special men, going and presenting the Holy Ghost gospel, not just this religious system of Methodist and Episcopalian and Catholic. That all been there, all that religion. They knew all that. They were moving with Holy Ghost power to cast out demons and heal the sick. And so this devil is not to be played with, and you need to have accountability. You get out here on your own, you're vulnerable. You know, Christians were called to be have a cloud of great witnesses around them. They were not to neglect the assembly of the saints. Many people got in the habit of not doing so, and that happens here. People won't go to a church because they don't practice deliverance. Well, they're getting people saved, and they're preaching the gospel and they love people, man, that seems like a good group of people to invest into or to live life, and they do have gifts. I mean, this guy up here at the Baptist church, I go there with my family, goes there. I say, I'd rather you go there than the Kundalini crackpot place when I'm not there and I'm on my prayer time and somebody's laying hands on my family and they don't know how to say, stop that, we have free will, don't put your hands on me, I'm not receiving that, you know, and I got a sick family. So they don't do any of that up there. But people are getting saved and baptized, and those testimonies are real before they go into those baptismal tanks. Some of them, you know, maybe not the most powerful of conversion, but some of them are without a doubt exactly how someone, you know, comes into the light and turns their life over to Jesus as the Son of God. So we're supposed to fellowship with the saints, not the, those are the called out ones, not the perfect people, right? And so you need to be a part of a body of Christ. And I think you do need to be wise. I mean, there's some crackpots out there, and I'm not being harsh. The devil has entered the Church of God. I went to one where they were, it was a huge seminar. I mean, it was, Mike talked me into going to it. And I said, Mike, I'm leaving and I'm going first. You invited me, so I'm gonna dip out first. Then you can dip out later. I don't think we should dip together. But it was just craziness about politics and this Donald Trump, if this is what God can do with this person, imagine what he's gonna do. You know, dude, I don't trust in natural man. You're not supposed to follow baby Christians. The first few years of your life, you're supposed to sit down as a Christian and listen. Can you evangelize and tell people what the Lord did? Absolutely. The woman at the well did that to the community, brought them all out to see Jesus. But you're not supposed to be in leadership, right? You're not supposed to be winning authority over people. And it's just, it was very fleshly. You're not supposed to follow man. You can get a curse on your life as a born-again Christian for following a man, trusting in a man. Now, of course, you know, God gives the gifts of leadership to people, pastors and teachers and evangelists, and those are given for the edification of the saints. But it says you're supposed to test everything. You know, prophetic words, you're supposed to test them. You're supposed to hold fast to what is true. You're supposed to confirm every word spoken over you out of the mouth of two or three witnesses. There have been so many people in here lost that had a prophetic word at their church, and now they're wondering why that thing hasn't came to fruition, and they're still suffering, and they haven't rose up to do all the things that the prophet said that they would do. And it's like, well, you should have confirmed that out of the mouth of two or three witnesses. If it's from God, they're coming. And then the second and the third witness could add a little more to it. Like, just be patient, you know, learn and study and show yourself approved. Take on the mindset of a worker so you don't need to be ashamed. Being able to rightfully divide the word of truth, you have to go through the process. So, but they just take that one word. I'm going to change the world. I'm going to go to, there's been a lot of people came in here, told me I've had a lot of them that I was going to fill stadiums. And one girl, you know, she's, I see you. And I said, oh, praise God. You know, well, I'm going to work to fill this place up first. You know, I'm not thinking about a stadium. I'm not against that. I'm not discrediting that, but I have to be faithful with the little first. And you gotta learn with the little. You got to see the little mature and grow. Then you got to learn to disregard things that aren't beneficial, you know. There's some things that are a part of you that can come into your ministry that just aren't supposed to be there. You had a question, ma'am? Sorry, I didn't.
Oh, I was going back to what you were saying about Summerall, and I've heard the saying that God will not remove an anointing from someone, but when he doesn't take back his gift. I just wanted to get more information about whether you think that's the case or not.
Oh, with him? I mean, he was 80. You know what I'm saying? I mean, there's a lot of toxins in this world, you know. I mean, he went around, man, you know, he probably caught a couple bugs and parasites traveling to the third world. You know, that guy, he used his life up for good. I'm not disrespecting the guy, and he was older, right? I don't know when these things happen. But the things I was kind of thinking about is someone should have had the gall to pull him aside and say, hey, bro, this, sir, don't call him bro, he's 81. sir, these things are, what scriptures are you getting? Right? What? I want to learn more about this. Show me the scriptures. Well, there are no scriptures for that, right? And so you can do it lovingly. You know, it says you're not to rebuke an older man. You know, you're supposed to be gentle, right? So Rod Parsley should have did that, but and he's on his way, and I could be interpreting, forgive me, but he's on his way to building Dominion College, right? And he's got some money, and he got him going. So whatever the reason, no one's calling him out. And so he was speaking with a boldness. He was using that as a testimony of the power that God gave him. But see, the danger is now other people are going to start cursing people. And I know a person, a good friend of mine, and his dad was working at the Mayo Clinic. And his dad was a Jew. And, you know, he a lot of people say they're Jews. And I'm like, you look pretty German to me or European as you get. Not this guy. I mean, he's got the woolly hair, the large nose. I mean, he's Jewish. He's got the Jewish name. Anyway, they started doing some anti-Semitic stuff. And he had it on paper. And he had the emails. And so they went in front of these lawyers. They don't lawyer up. And he starts hammering this lawyer and this board at the Mayo Clinic. And he comes right out of the gate threatening them and saying, hey, I know that most of your donors are Jewish. They find out you tolerate anti-Semitic treatment towards one of your chief contractors. This ain't going to go well for your donations. He said, besides that, I've gotten thousands of followers on social media, and I'm going to have them come on down here with signs, and they're going to talk about how you being anti-Semitic. Then I'm going to call the news and tell them to get a wind of what's going on with 100 people out in front of Mayo Clinic and what's been going on. And it's going to start. The flow of free money is going to stop for you. And he intimidated them into a $500,000 settlement. And he was bragging about it. And I was like, man, hospitals, I wouldn't want to mess with hospitals. You go there, they fixed a lot of legs, they've stitched a lot of faces, but they got a lot of bodies on their hands too. I don't care if they're the Mayo Clinic or the top. One of the top leading causes of death is the misprescription of drugs. People die in surgery, people go to hospitals and they get MRSA and all kinds of things, man. Bodies drop dead there. I don't like hospitals. My buddy that got me into the jail ministry was a chaplain for 20 years at the hospital. I went twice. I said, he was let down. I said, bro, sir, he was elderly. He was 82. I did not use that word. I said, I'm not called to do this. I don't like this. This is too much pressure. Everyone's sick. You've got a gift here. You're chiseling away. You're loving people. You got something here. I see what I got. It's for the jail. It's for the highways and byways. This isn't how I'm built. I had a surgery one time. They removed. It was weird too. Not to get sidetracked, as I'm known to do. No faces in the rear from anyone who's no signals. I had to get my adenoids taken out in the third grade. But it's a teacher that recommends to my parents I should have my adenoids taken out because I breathe through my mouth too much. Well, anyway, that's odd as I think back. And I'm in this hospital in the recovery for 2 days. I remember one thing was terrorized. The nurse came in, you got to take a bath now. And I could barely move. Would you like a sponge bath or would you like to get in that shower yourself? And boy, I mustered up every bit of strength I could in the third grade to get in that shower. Fear came upon me. My parents weren't there. I just remember having a dry throat. And I don't know if it was something from my childhood that triggered from that surgery, but I don't like hospitals. If you're there, I'll pray for you. I'll come see you. I believe in miracles in a hospital. You got to go there. It's a mandate. Where were you when I was sick? You didn't come and pray for me. But working there, no, that's not going to be my ministry. So the anointing that God gives, yeah, he gives the gifts. They're not taken away. My buddy didn't lose his gift. He lost that $500,000. He was trading cryptocurrency, and you got to trade, and you do this day trading, and then you got to put it back into your Bit wallet. Otherwise, cyber people can see you're trading. They're inside these other non-Bitcoin cryptocurrencies. They start tracking you. They got in and stole $530,000. This is just a few years later. So an ill-gotten treasure has no value. It was exactly the same number of what he got. You don't mess around. I'm not saying if someone botches your body, you know, did they need to compensate him, a year or two maybe because you got to go get another job, you know, possibly. But they went in strong arm bullying. He had a gift, and boy, that guy got scared. Those threats scared the Mayo Clinic. They went into a conference. They said, okay, hey, you know, we're going to settle with you. What do you want? And he came hard, and he said, this is it or nothing. And they came back and said, we'll cut you the check, but your dad is done. He's got to leave now. You know, and so can't have you around anymore. This isn't, you're gone now. Anyway, the money was gone. So, yeah, God gives you gifts. I was preaching how I ended up in here 17 years ago. I felt bad losing my money, and I'm smoking marijuana. And I remember thinking, man, the first time I did it, is God going to allow me in these jails to actually preach after I just did this all high like this? And I remember going to go in, you got to have these badges or you're not getting through the first gate, let alone the next six. And I don't have it. I'm like, oh, this is it. I thought there could be a supernatural barrier, but it was in my car and I was able to go in there. And then I was able to preach. And then I was able to get people saved. And I'm like, man. And the devil goes, yeah, maybe smoking marijuana isn't that bad. Look at this thing. You know, look at this. This is the same thing. The gift's still moving. This guy's crying. Now, you didn't feel God as much. Your prayers, there was doubt and unbelief in your prayers because you were living double-minded. But, hey, man, it doesn't seem to be that big a deal because everything was basically the same. Oh, see, he's a masterful deceiver. He'll deceive you. And a lot of people, they live in sin. Like, if you have a pornography problem, if you have any sexual immorality problem, you know, you need to correct that. You need to correct that. And that'll show you how bad you want your ministry, because you should be able to control your body in sanctification and honor. I mean, people get slip-ups. I mean, some woman told me the other day, some guy had a tight shirt, and she goes, yeah, she shouldn't do that. Some women still have lust problems. I said, a woman with lust off a bicep? I never crossed my mind. And I said, well, if that's how women know they could fall subject to that temptation, man, you haven't been to LA Fitness. I mean, they're working to build their, I'm not even kidding, they're there to build their OnlyFans accounts. They'll give you the OnlyFans number. I see them working out, talking to their OnlyFans so-called boyfriends while they're working out. They pay to talk to their so-called girlfriend while they're exercising. It's the land of delusions. Well, anyway, these things are out there. So people, they make mistakes. You slip, you fall, but you got to learn how to get back up. And then you got to learn to do things strategic so that you don't fall into the same thing again and again and again. Because if you've been here for deliverance, you know, 15 times for porn addiction. Well, let's go all the way back a little further. You backtracked it to here to stop doing that. Now we better backtrack it on a little back further so we can uproot that thing, right? So if you really want your ministry, and I would say stop ministering for a while. Now, you can share the love of Jesus, but you discipling people, I'm not saying abandon them. You say, hey, I'm taking a week to really get close to the Lord. They'll think they'll be excited about what comes out for the next week, you know, next time they see you. But you should pull back a little bit and recalibrate, because you can't do that. You're going to get someone sick. You know, it happened to someone in here. And me and Michael say he was the most gifted spiritually person that we ever saw ever come through this place out of the gate.
Wow.
Hands down, to this day, that was over 10 years ago. And we have not seen somebody more bold, more confident, and the anointing was there. And I mean, he was ripping spirits out of here. Mike used to have a deliverance minister that had been in this for 40 years. And man, he could knock some people around and, you know, just speaking. And this guy was close second out of the gate. But one time he was looking at pornography, thought he could cast all his demons out before he went and ministered. He felt the obligation to come and minister because the opportunity was presented to himself. He didn't want to lose his slot. He didn't want to lose his favor with me or Mike. So he came in, And it was either two or three women said, when that man touched me, something came into me, and I think it's lust. I mean, it was boom, download. I mean, those women stood up boldly to say, hey, one could discern it. Someone thought something just came in. So you got to take care of your own self, you know. Some people are hard to love. You know, when you've been backstabbed, you know, talking about your families, by your husband, you're belittled continually. Some wives, man, I look at them and I go, bro, I hit the lotto when I got married. Gee, you did not. You know, they got tough situations, tough ground. And that is a work in progress, right? But if you keep taking offenses with them, do you really think you should have a women's ministry group to be helping the women? You know, now, does that mean your husband or your wife is going to be fixed before you do it? No, but you taking those offenses, you being let down, you being ran over by them, there has to be a little bit of separation. There has to be a little bit of revelation that there's some spirits in them and a hard heart on top of it. So yeah, there's some spirits and there's a hard heart. If they're saved, well, we got to get the hard heart softened before we can get the spirits out. You can't go spirits out, get to the hard heart, get that fixed up, easy peasy, no. But you need to stop taking the offenses, and you need to stop blaming your husband or why your ministry is not flourishing, you know. And then if you're a man, you know, it's like, hey, there's an anointing that you have. And if it's to help the body of Christ, it will be released to help your wife. But the problem is, they want to take off running in a sprint with their ministry, but they don't want to come and work over here because they know it's going to take a lot of time, and they got to wait on a miracle because they've tried everything to help that person. But now it's in a position where only God can change. Any other questions?
Sure.
Go ahead.
First of all, it's an honor to see you personally because I see you every. I try to come on every Wednesday.
Excellent! Good to see you.
I'm heading back today to Delaware, and I was here for Deliverance. I just want to know some of the things because when I had my the first session on Thursday, Brother Mark was like, "Avira, just watch out because the enemy will come after you." And it wasn't like 4 hours, my car got stolen. I got the call that somebody ran over my car. So I, at this point, because it's been really, really crazy in my life, I want to maintain this time that I took off to come and seek the face of God and get delivered. And I also want to be consistent in that to be able to protect this place that I am right now with God. Moving forward, what are the different advice that you can give for me to be very conscious and guide myself right now?
Okay, so if you couldn't hear that online, her question was, I just got a deliverance. I turned my life completely over to the Lord. Mike warned me that they're going to make a counter attack, and then her car got smashed. Well, he's trying to incite fear. Sometimes you'll use up all your resources, and what he'll do is make you think that he can do this forever. He can't. Scripturally, the Lord is going to turn around everything the devil means for harm. He'll turn around for good. And if you look at Paul's life, I mean, he's walking. I mean, you got to be thinking, you know, when you've had 5 times 40 lashes minus 1, your skin is keloided. You got wounds on top of wounds. So those never truly heal. And whenever you move, the back starts cracking and you start bleeding. So here he is, doesn't have the fine clothes he used to have as a Pharisee. He doesn't have the eloquence. He doesn't have the persuasive words in which he used to trust in. And now he's got a beat up, mangled body. I mean, he was stoned and left for dead. I mean, you got to have some serious knots on your head. I mean, you got to have some marks on your face. People got to say, who is this freak show? You know, if God's for you, what is that? Right? And devil had to be hammering him. Are you sure? Are you sure this isn't the time to quit? Or is it sure you still got an uncle? He loves you, man. He's got some cash. He's got some extra place for you, man. Are you sure you don't want to take a sidetrack, right? So everybody has to overcome. And overcoming right out of the gate is, hey, he can throw stuff, But no matter what, I'll be raised up. And that takes faith. You can't do that in the natural. It exposes someone that truly has faith in God's word, or if you're growing or need to grow more, or if you have no faith, it's exposed because, hey, God's going to come through. And I look back at the things where I had faith for when they were bad, they always turned around for good. I was set for the rest of my life. I truly had a rich uncle that made computer programs and chips for everything in Silicon Valley. He's been up there for 30 years. And I could borrow all the money I wanted at a low interest rate, get into biodiesel, and I lost money myself, but I lost, you know, his $1 million. It was, hey, he doesn't have the golden hand. Grandma told my aunt, hey, he's got the golden hand. God's hand is on him. He's blessed. And the first deals were all blessed. But once it went bad, I lost that opportunity to get the money. Then in return, the money that was lost, I knew how to invest it into real estate, and I know you hold the properties. I had rental property since the early 90s. Since I was in college, I owned my first one, and it was over, right? But the devil meant for harm because he knew that I was building my kingdom in God and also in the world. So he has the right to test everything that's built in the world. If it's built on the rock, yeah, he can test it. It'll be a storm, a flood, a beating, but it stands. But if it's on the sand, it's fleshly, it comes crashing down. It suffers the consequences, right? And so in return, I had to go through deliverance. I got so negative that only a few of my friends could be around me, which were all professional negative people, and we just gelled together. But other people that were, you know, trying to overcome and work through issues, boy, man, it had to be hard for them. You know, I did hear it a couple times from people because I had laser pinpoint accuracy on the negativity. And then that led to some bitterness. It led to, you know, everything getting infiltrated, right? But then I learned about deliverance. So it was the best thing that ever happened to me. It was the worst thing financially. It's the best thing spiritually. There's still some things I got to overcome. You know, I battle the ministry not getting bigger, right? I everything I always done, everything should grow. Your portfolio should grow. Your muscles should grow. Muscles don't even grow when you get in your 50s, boy. You're looking to maintain and stop the unwanted growth in your body. But it's not always about bigger, bigger, bigger. Sometimes I understand biblically that we have to be more equipped. We have to be more stable. We got to be deep enough to handle that, right? It takes a lot of people to run a ministry. When we get 40 people here and there's only two, it was tough. It was a tough night. It's hard. Some people can leave. You never want anyone to leave. So it kind of takes one minister to every 10 people. Not that it has to. Win Worley did a great job, you know, barking them out. God will always supply the anointing for what what you need, you know, when you're doing his work. But you know, Mike's had the vision. He's trying to fight that vision from coming to fruition, which will have a place that was, it was either hundreds or thousands. So he's not buying any building after this that doesn't seat at least 500 people. That's the minimum. And that means we can get to thousands if we run a couple services or a few services a day. So, you know, the enemy wants to try to fight that. I want that to happen. I want that to happen sooner. But God's going to take care of everything he spoke, everything he's going to do. So I got to be patient, and then I got to continue to learn. But pride will say, hey, I know enough to do this. I've done this, and I've seen this happen. And hey, when you send the crashing anointing, man, that gathers people, Lord. So send that again, right? So I need to always adjust myself, recalibrate, and come back with what? Yeah, you got the power, but you had to have the love, and love trusts God. Right? Love is patient, you know, and then I got to be kind. And then in return, there'll be a soundness of my mind. Anytime there's insecurities or there's fear or, you know, there's times that it got kind of slow here in the winter coming in. I was like nine people. I drive down to the jail and get 35, right? Like if it's about people, but that's a slower process to make disciples. We're helping some people that are already full go in their ministries. We're already helping disciples, and they're already got a lot of fruit connected to them. So this is a special ministry. And then we do have the people that come up out of the highways and byways and family members that are bringing their hurt and wounded family and friends, whatnot. So it's a little bit of everything. So we always got to adjust and not look, every minister, not look by sight. You got to look by faith and have some discernment then of what you need to do to see those things happen. If God spoke it and it's been confirmed, or you've been there before and now there's a time where it's went slower, but you got to continue to learn. Any other questions before we get going?
Want to look back at that Lester Summerall thing again. You sent me those videos. One of the craziest parts was after he had said that, the crowd started clapping and you know, there were amen and stuff like that. So that's to show you that when people do that stuff, it does filter out into the congregation, right? So he's cursing people now. Everybody in that congregation, everybody that listened to those videos for years and years, well, if he did it, I can do that too. I'm going to start cursing my relatives. I'm going to start cursing this, you know. And it reminds me also of the Todd Bentley videos. You know, those Todd Bentley videos when they used to expose him, he was saying that the Holy Spirit told him to kick old ladies in the face with his biker boot and get healed. But no, it was the same thing.
I hate to tell you that, but those were probably fabrications.
But the congregation in there, when he did that,
they tried booting a couple people.
They were excited about it, too. They were like, yeah, they're laughing, and you know what I'm saying? So it does, it spread.
Oh, without a doubt. What you're saying is true, 100%. Yeah, you got to be careful. You got to be careful for the way that you lead and the things that you teach, because you're teaching it. The things that are learned from the teacher, they implement. And, of course, the guy that's changed the world, who is in Mike's Hall of Fame, you know, he's saying, hey, this guy did things the 5 or 10 people did in the history of America, you know, front runner and all that. So, yeah, we got to be careful what we're doing. You better be able to back up what you're preaching with some scriptures.
Yeah, I'll just add to that, because a lot of times people are looking for perfection in ministers, and Frank Hammond used to teach territorial warfare, and we don't recommend that. Dangerous. My point in bringing him up is nobody has the perfect ministry life. No one's got it all right. And just because they're teaching something that's wrong or you know, we don't see it in scripture, doesn't mean God's not going to use them. We have to use our discernment.
Oh, without a doubt, you know, God will use you, but there was a lot of things going on with that. You know, that's in a house of 2,000 people. Someone should have brought that to correction. But what that was saying was everybody was fearful from him to bring correction because of what he did. So, yeah, does everyone have some issues in life? Yeah, absolutely. They're in your flesh. They're not in your spirit. Your spirit's been sealed with the Holy Ghost and promised. All the good things you do are going to come out of your spirit, man. The sinful things, carnal things, are going to come out of your flesh. So that's a constant battle for every minister, no matter where you've been. I remember the first couple times I saw Mike Smith. It took me 2 years to find out he was human. And he was telling people how he gets them praying in tongues, you know. And he's like, just follow me, you know. The guy's freak, like, whoa, we can't be training people how to pray in tongues. Mike's like, no. Theirs will sound as different, you know, as our thumbprints are different as anyone else. And then the guy just shut it down. Like, he wouldn't listen to another thing Mike said. We cannot be training people how to speak in tongues. That's not how it's done. And I remember Mike kind of squirreling a little bit, like, you know, like he couldn't even say anything. The guy just shut it down. And I was like, oh, wow, there's some human sensitivity in there, you know, and I just modify Mike's a little bit. I say, well, pray mine in your mind, in my mind, and then something will boot out of you. So I adjusted it a little bit, right? So So I'm not saying his way is not good. He's got hundreds of people praying in tongues, so that's pretty successful, and you could do that. But this way, if someone is like Pentecostals, it falls on you when you're up at that altar repenting. Then everyone's praying that the Holy Spirit falls down, and then these kids, you know, I've seen them, young kids, 10 even, you know, get the Holy Ghost praying in tongues. And I know real tongues from fake tongues. I know the Hyundai, Robai, Kawasaki, you know, all that made up stuff too. I can discern it, right? So I could tell those kids have real tongues. So that's where they came from. So, but when you curse people, man, you're going to get cursed. So that's not like someone having some problems. Like, no, not to call Julie out, but since she brought the question, sometimes she has bad hair days. I don't know if it's because it's desert, it's the desert wind, and it's 116. She's got the window down. I mean, no one's perfect. We got a lot of grace for everybody. But if you're cursing somebody, you better watch out. That curse is coming back to you. You know, I got a problem that for some reason, if you're busted up, I can shake your hand and ask you how you doing. Like, there's no reservation to getting my love to that person. But if you got it all together, or you're looking fine, I kind of got the attitude of, well, I don't want to intrude on you. You know, maybe it's from when I went to Scottsdale Bible, and I tried to meet people during the recession. Like, good to meet you, honey. Step back. They could want money. Things are tight. I mean, it was weird. Like, people did not want to get to meet you unless you. It was like you wanted to meet the leadership. People did not want to meet the people. And maybe it was because of the recession and things were hard. When I went to the first Bible study, there was like a group of 10 behind the pastor. He goes, hey, good to meet you. And it's like, hey, you don't happen to have any work in where you work or your company, do you? And there was like 10 guys like losing their jobs, their families. Just like, no, I'm into construction. Things really went kind of down for me too. And then they kind of dispersed. But it was a time that was, maybe it was that. So I need to be kinder to people. There's been people to say, man, I didn't think you liked me. You know, you looked at me funny. And I was like, ah, man, I probably look funny. And you probably gazed eye to eye and thought that was looking at you. But no, I wasn't looking at you funny. So I got to overcome. You know, you do need to show love for people and get your love to people. So I'm growing and everybody's growing, everybody. And even if, you know, you're the founder of the ministry, you know, hey, you're human. You know, he had a good thing. He had 1,000 people. At that point, 500 people that could pray in tongues. We're trying to train the staff, and the guy wouldn't listen to him one inch. Just, no, no, no. And then he had his mom backed him up. Absolutely not. And she was moving her hand around. And I was like, oh, man, that's not nice. And I was like, I thought, man, I was like, soldier says, okay, I'll move another direction. No, he was human, you know, and we all got humanity to us, which we're humans. We never overcome humanity. We're sensitive. Nobody likes to be belittled. Nobody likes to be disrespected. No one likes to be have no importance, no voice of significance, right? So there's always your humanity. And then also we have a sin nature, right? And people do some bonehead stuff. You know, but that's why it's so important to have a bond of unity so that people can understand where you're coming from. And that's why it says an older man, you're not supposed to rebuke him harshly, but you're supposed to do it gently, right? And then you're not supposed to, you know, just hear one accusation. You know, you got to have a couple witnesses before you come to somebody. There was, everything had to be decently in order, so they understood the sensitivity of people. And also that, hey, people do have sin and we need to deal with it, you know, lovingly. But yeah, territorial warfare. She said, Frank Hammond used to do territorial warfare. Well, now we have the opportunity to learn from all these people. They were kind of the front runners. Mike was on a mission from God for years. I mean, he went beast mode, for lack of a better word, into every book he could read. Any minister came to the valley, he was there. And he knew something wasn't right. He wanted God. He wanted everything. This is his story. Some of you have listened to the early testimony of Mike. And then finally, he comes across this book that explained it was demons, right? So you talk about Frank Hammond, man, he's one of the front runners, right? Win Wordley, this is one of the front runners. You go back to all these guys, Lester Summerall, these were the front runners. The devil had captivated, everything was religion. Lighting candles. I mean, it was going through the motions. Religion, the devil had taken over, but God was now mounting up and equipping us. So we're gleaning from all of them. And then we're learning the things that have been proven to be harmful, right? But God did give them grace. God didn't allow them to get taken out. But in return, you can see the residual fruits and what they left over, right? That the devil did devour some of their disciples and some of their fruits. There was an anointing on them to protect them because they were learning this from the Holy Spirit themselves. They didn't have the books. They didn't have the instructions. Got time for one more question and we'll go. Anything else? Anybody else? Oh, no, you can call me dude. You can do that. And then when I get like 70, you can say sir. Right. Yeah. I'm good with all that. But feel free. You know, if we don't hear it, then how are you going to make an effort? Right. And anybody's brain computes pretty good once you get over the little kick in the stomach of you're wrong is, wow, if they saw that, how many other people am I influencing negatively? Because what they saw of you at church or in your ministry is probably a light version of what came out to other people, right? If it's there. So you can do a self-evaluation to see, hey, is this spiritual or is this just a bad attitude or is this a bad doctrine that I picked up? Well, where's the scriptures? Like I said, someone should have went to Lester Summerall and said, sir, what scriptures are you using for this? I'd like to learn more. There are no scriptures. There's none. And so that would leave him with some thought and say, hey, phase two, just like Mike said, was, hey, you spoke that. Don't you think 2,000 people at World Harvest Church are going to try to implement what you've done because of all the wonderful things you've done that, hey, you know, at that point, there wasn't 100 men done what he had done on planet, you know, in America, right? And so, so everybody has to hear some things, right? That's just the way it works. So I want to talk about taking thoughts captive. And when you're working with people, this is your problem. This is the problem that you're going through or whoever you're helping is the thoughts that go through their mind. And you have to understand that thoughts come from somewhere, right? But if a thought is received by a person, then it becomes their thought. If that thought becomes their action, they gave place to the devil. Once the devil's been there for a long time, he sets up an infrastructure in the way that some people can't stand correction. They can't stand correction. Some people have pride that they're so high up here and the devil has put a fortress around them because of all the things they did that only someone at this level could come and bring any correction. I had a friend like that and he saw me as a jail preacher. And therefore I couldn't bring any correction to him because there's no way he'd take correction from about 5 people, but those 5 people didn't walk with him on a regular basis. They weren't even in the same state. They were his mentors from past. Well, he'd accept from them, but someone had to be at this level because pride was so rooted up there. But the reality is, it was the pride came in when he was a kid of no significance. He was kind of a non-athletic, non-fit, and didn't have a lot of persuasion. And then, so the world, when you go to the public school, you got to have something in the natural. If you don't, then you better do something that somebody else won't do for them. Otherwise, your value is way down there. That's what the public school system teaches you. A friend was just telling me that his daughters are going through bullying. And I'm like, man, they still do that? Like, man, haven't we outgrown that? But no, kids in the sin nature and hurting people is real, right? And so he was tired of being hurt. Now he had the Holy Ghost. Now he had an anointing. And the pride says, man, we're not going to listen to very many people. He was actually going to use that at one level to get him in trouble. Because he wouldn't listen to anyone else. And then he would reflect that the people he listened to changed the world. The people that he listened to changed communities. The people he listened to had so much influence that they could have sit downs with governors and mayors of cities. And so a person that thinks he sees something that's a Christian, well, hey, you're boxed out, right? So thoughts are powerful. Thoughts are powerful, and they build an infrastructure once they get in there. Thoughts come from persons. Demons are persons. Sometimes people just, they don't have any revelation. They think demons are just spirits. Like a spirit is just the influence behind something, maybe even some power to persuade someone. No, demons are disembodied spirits. They have a mind, they have a mentality. When a demon comes out of a man, he says to himself, that's a person, I'll return to the home from which I was cast out of. And then he goes back, his now investigation is, hey, it's vacant. Now he goes into a decision-making process. I'm gonna go back and I'm gonna get seven worse than myself so we don't get thrown out again. I'm getting some infrastructure in here. And it says the second stage is worse than the first. It says, so it shall be with this wicked generation. Well, why was he saying and breaking down the terminology of a demon? Some people say, well, he's just speaking to those people. It's just an analogy. Yeah, the analogy is true, how demons work. And then he's talking to the people that were wicked, that they're going to get reinfected because they're not changing.
Can they also take over a person, become a person, and maybe get rid of their spirit or something?
I mean, people can become possessed. They can become possessed, but born-again Christians can't be.
Yeah, that's what's going on.
But yeah, you don't think these people smoking fentanyl are completely taken over by demons?
Yeah.
If you walk like this, and you, no offense, you got infections in your arm, and I saw a guy, I don't see him anymore. He used to walk back and forth on this street, and then one day he had his arm cut off, and this one was in a cast, and he was still walking. You know he was going to get high. Now he needed some painkillers, right? And then I didn't see him anymore. That's a possession that you wouldn't stop, that there's no five-alarm fire wake-up calls to stop what you're doing. For sure, they're possessed.
I got people manifested in my house, men and women manifest in my house when I leave, and they're humans, and they keep stealing my stuff. And I called the cops 20 times, and the cops put me in the psych ward the other day because I'm making too many phone calls to the cops, and they can disappear at will.
The people?
People, humans. And they're following me around town when I take the bus up here. And one guy came up, talked to me, says, how you doing? And then he disappeared right in front of me. And I got these white-haired men following me, says, I'm God. And I got a demon in me right now. It's blinking my eyes. I'm attached to a spirit realm, and I can't get rid of it.
Well, I think you kind of answered the whole theme of your problems is because they're in here, they will manifest out there.
Yeah.
I saw a person disappear one time at the gym, and I told everybody about it. And everybody I told, it was a little bit even Mike is like, now say this again. And I said, hey, this is where it went. And then some said, go in that room and see him. Why would I go in there? And they went in there, weren't there. So that's real. They can do some things. But the problem isn't them being able to disappear. The problem isn't with people stealing your stuff. Those are manifestations. The problem is what you said. You got a spirit in your head, and it's making you do A and B, right?
Yeah.
So you got to stop that. That you can stop.
I just got back from Jesus Lord Outreach trying to cast it out.
Okay.
He's still attached to me.
Yeah, well, because he built an infrastructure.
Right,
he built an infrastructure, and I know the infrastructure is still there because you said, hey, this is happening constantly. I can't stop it. These people with white hair and these people are disappearing. Those are manifestations of a spirit here that is trying to crack you. The police, you call the police take you to the psych ward, and the devil's trying to give you a foreshadow of your future. This is where I want you. That's where he wants you.
In front of me the other day, and I threw a bottle of water at him, and I knocked him down on the bike. The police came in, and he took off, and I went to the church by my house. They blew up my car. They got some kind of electrical energy. They blew up my car. I have a hard time making it here.
So you got to stop all that right now, because all those stories, just we gotta shelf them. Not saying they're not real, because I know this stuff's real, but you need to literally shelf that, because that'll never stop unless you get the one out of your head. If you think this has to change with the one in your head, then this never changes. You don't have authority over that. They can do all kinds of crazy things. Without the mercy of God, man, the devil would burn this building down. He'd have somebody shot and crashed every time they wanted here. But he can only do what he has permission to do. So the devil's allowing that. Lord's allowing that devil to manifest so that you can do with the work that he's giving you the power to do, which is getting him out of your mind. But if you're fighting today to get all these things changed, it ain't going to happen. You need to fight solely of getting this out of your head. Slowly that will change. But you're already doing the things to get you locked up. You can't throw bottled waters.
These guys keep manifesting invisibly in front of me. It's not my head. Well, I'm not psychiatric.
Not yet, but he's trying to get you there. That's why he sent you there. He's showing you. He wants you cracked. So you better take it serious, because he's trying to get in there. He's in there already at a level, because you told me you keep blinking your eyes, and this other stuff's happening.
It's a demon in me.
He's
looking out my eyes right now and keeps blinking my
eyes. Well, then you got one goal, is to get that out. Today, that's it, right? Today, that's it. Don't tell me anything else.
I need him out.
Okay, well, you're going to have to fight him out of your head. Don't fight your other problems. Don't fight the thieves stealing your stuff. Don't fight the cops. Don't fight spirits of coming up out of nowhere. You fight what you know. God will give you grace and power for what you know. And we'll help you here in a little bit. Thanks for coming. So taking thoughts captive, a thought that's entertained becomes a voice. I got thoughts. Just like Julie said, none of us are perfect. I got thoughts. And I don't even pay them any mind. I just let them go. Or I say, ooh, that's wicked. I reject that. I mean, there's all kinds of thoughts. It's like, you know, if you're on a race car track, you're going to be on the road with a bunch of race cars. Well, I'm on the freeway of life. Man, we got mopeds on the freeway. We got trucks. We got cars. We got motorcycles. I mean, there's all kinds of thoughts in this life, right? But I'm not accepting them. I'm not accepting them. And if there's something that kind of, ooh, maybe, oh, remember that, right? Those are the ones he sends repetitively. I don't ever have thoughts of killing myself. He might have tried that a couple times, and I never wanted to do it as a kid. I was like, nah, I'd never do that. I think I even said a statement like, man, I'd rob banks, and I'd hijack a helicopter. I'd go out with a bang, and you know, before I killed myself. Like, it was just never... It never registered for me, not disrespecting anybody that has, but the point is, he sends thoughts repetitively where there's some weight to it. Is he talking about your deficiencies? Is he talking about your insecurities? Is he reminding you of things that were done to you that were wrong and harmful, right? So thoughts are gonna come, but it doesn't mean anything, right? Like, I've had people confessing, going, man, what is this, man? I ain't gay. You know, I'm all man here. I ain't never done none of that stuff, man. What are these thoughts? And I'm like, look, why are you tripping on thoughts? Who said they were yours? Well, they're in my head. I said, well, you the devil is a warrior. He's fighting with thoughts. He wants them to root up in your head. You're rejecting them. It's just now you've got this insecurity, like what's happening? And I said, well, hey, let's go back to the root anyway. And the problem was, he wasn't a porn watcher, but he slept with all his girlfriends. You know, it was like, hey, well, if we're dating, that's just what I do. I try not to, but we always do. And then we ended up moving into each other. It's a residence, because we need, you know, I'm not rich, right? So he's got all these excuses. Well, now the spirit's coming for more. A spirit just wants to terrorize somebody. So some thoughts are offensive. Some thoughts are something you would never do. Some thoughts, though, correlate with what they want you to do, or what they know would hurt you in some way, shape, or fashion. But the thought isn't your thought until you entertain it. If you entertain that thought, then it becomes a voice. My sheep know my voice. Now, thought doesn't make you follow anything. Voices make you follow things. So my sheep know my voice, the voice of another, they won't follow. The voice always comes from a person. People have oil. Well, now we have AI, but I don't even think AI is real AI. I think that's all just stuff computed in there. I think that's just created to create a little fear. But voices come from people. If it's a radio show, it's a record, that's a voice that was recorded. It's TV programming. It's coming from somewhere, right? So if a voice is coming, you got to know where it's coming from, right? And if it's talking to you, well, now there's some headway in there. We got to reject voices, right? So that if thought rejected, it'll go away, right? If it's already rooted up and it's a voice, man, there has to be some deliverance at some level. You can say, hey, I don't want that. I know that's you. It can be light deliverance, you know, simple deliverance. Or unfortunately, like my brother was testifying that, hey, man, now something's got in my head and it even makes me blink out of my eyes continually. And it's not me, right? So it got in there. If you want it out of there, we got to figure out sometimes how it got in there. Well, it always gets in there at the root when you listen to it, right? So that's where you're going back to, right? And then if you do receive a thought, if it's negative, it's about your past life, about your deficiencies, insecurities, fears. If you receive that thought, it becomes yours. It becomes your thought. Now you've owned it, right? You've owned it. I think I manifested some of my receding hairline. Because one time I took some steroids and my forehead felt a little smooth. I said, oh, that's not like the texture of my regular forehead. Some hair's falling out. And I started going, oh my goodness, my hair is going to fall out. I started to go fund myself hair transplant fund. And I would put all my single dollars into a jar, a box. My buddy had to go and get that box and bail me out of jail one time when I was 20. But I was manifesting something. I look at the photos and I'm like, man, I'm tripping. I don't even think I was losing any hair. It was just in my mind. And it was creating fear. In return, fear. And once a spirit gets in, he can literally start manifesting things. People get bulimia. Right? Oh, I'm fat. Well, I'm not going to eat. Well, sure enough, they're not fat. And then pretty soon, they're way, way below not being fat. Now they're eating up their muscles. You know, now they're putting their health in a negative, in jeopardy, right? So these spirits, they have power, right? Once they get in. And then obviously, he didn't really care about my hairline, and my hairline wasn't going to change my life. He wants in there, and now he'll move to something else, right? So he'll come in through something you don't want. He'll come in through something traumatic. He'll come in through something sinful. However he gets in, he just wants in there. And then he moves around. He's moving around from one problem to the next. And then my problem soon became, you know, football was over. Man, I need money. I've never met someone you could call a loser that had a lot of money. Man, I'm avoiding that, and I'm going to have this. Doesn't matter if you get fat, don't matter if my hair falls out. If I got money, that's respect, because that's the way I treated people, right? Anybody's dad that had a nice house, we didn't mess around with that dad. You know, if they were kind of drinking beers and had a shabby house, you know, we didn't treat them with the highest of respect as kids, but somebody that had their stuff together, man, we were over there and we were on our P's and Q's because we gave that person respect for what they were able to achieve and what they were able to do with their life. And so in my mind, that voice goes, this is what we're going to invest into, right? Because ultimately he wants you to invest into this temporal world, and you can't serve two masters. You can't build your kingdom on this earth and store your riches in heaven. It doesn't work. At one point, there becomes the crossroads. There becomes the decision. And when he roots up in there, and plus he puts that fortress of lies around there to support him, and it's hard to get out of there, right? Most Christians, most rich Christians, they don't do anything for God. I went to these churches. They don't do anything for God. They go to church. They are moral people. They well tell their friends about the truth, but they never really laid their lives down. but they certainly have laid their lives down for their careers. They certainly have laid down their finances for their kids to get educations and to do these great things in the world. So according to the world, they're very successful. And even the church will embrace them and put them into leadership because of the good quality of families that they have and success they have intellectually and financially. So thought received becomes yours. Then when you act on those thoughts, that becomes you. As a man thinks, so is he. So if he's going to guide your life, he's first going to throw a thought. He needs you to receive that thought, or at least entertain that thought till it becomes a voice. Then that voice becomes an action. That action becomes you. And I became a person that invested myself in this world. And then sure enough, I'm telling you, the world will applaud you. I remember when I got a nice Mercedes, and I put some nice rims on it. I mean, I was in my 20s. I remember house moms, you know, with their minivans pumping their gas. And I could tell, like, she wishes in my mind. I mean, she could have thought, how'd this guy get this car? Are you robbing people? But in my mind, I thought, man, this lady knows I'm successful. She wishes how her husband would have been able to do what I'm doing, right? Like in my and people, certainly men will pat you on the back. They're always looking for a piece of the financial pie. They'll tell you what you have is great. They'll tell you they wish they had what you had financially. So the world will build an infrastructure that you're doing good, and it'll make you feel pretty good. And so what, one of the hard things about going through deliverance when you turn your life completely over to the Lord is now your reward system only comes from a very few amount of people that you're doing a good job. I mean, if there's one thing we could do better in here is tell each other. Sometimes I think, wow, this person's doing a really good job. But I don't even tell them sometimes. I should say those things. Like, hey, I think you're doing great. I know how hard this job is. I know how hard it is for everyone to come in here and counsel. Because there's one level where you get delivered, you overcame for that. Then you go to another level of deliverance to help people on the floor out there under the corporate anointing. But now when you're going to one-on-ones helping people, man, you've went to a real refining level with putting the misdeeds of your body to death and being committed to the Lord and dealing with all kinds of friction from the wicked one, trying to bring discouragement and affect you financially, relationally, everything that he can throw at you. So when you become a Christian, the world no longer applauds you. They no longer appreciate you like the world did. Man, I would get a new watch. Man, I'd get 10 people telling me that how they want that watch. You know, you had a nice house or all that. Man, people are like, wow, man, you're doing good. It's pat you on the back and encourage you to go and indulge and invest in some more. But now when you're a Christian, only a few people, only disciples can recognize what other disciples are doing. Christians are dime a dozen. Disciples are very few. And so, but what we do have is the voice of the Lord. And what happens is if you get running too far ahead of yourself, the Lord's voice is back here. And so then you got to run out on your own encouragement, which will wear thin, or you got to have some people pleasers around you, encouraging to go out to the distance that you're already at. But we need the voice of God. And my sheep know my voice. So the very definition of someone being delivered truly is not just their manifestations, is they stop listening to these negative voices and they're listening to the voice of God. And then they get encouraged to hear his voice and that he's very, from my experience, he's very patient. He's very, he just gives you some gems and you'll see what you do with them, right? And hey, I've made some moves where I retracted from them for whatever reason. I've had some where I ran out ahead of the place where the Lord was with all these blessings. And I've learned to kind of gauge where the Lord is. And I've suffered financially. I've suffered relationally. In my own mental state, I've suffered all of it when I get away from the voice of the Lord. So when you're truly gauging someone that's a disciple that you're investing into and helping them get delivered, that's what you're looking for, is they can hear God. Well, I don't hear him. Well, okay, he speaks through his word. You're not having the word of God running through your mind. One of the signs of when you're really getting someone delivered, there's sermons that are played in their mind, just in their mind, and songs they'll sing all night long. Like I used to get a the loop of whatever demonic song, you know, played at the gym or in my Sony Walkman, whatever it was, I'd get that playing in my head all night. Go get up, go to the bathroom, get something to eat. It just goes right back to playing. But when you go through deliverance, now the word of God is playing. That's a good sign. He's there. That person learns to stay in that sweet spot, so to speak. And because he'll keep doing that. Some things God does is a one-off. Like I've heard him audibly. I've talked back and forth to him one time. And haven't done it for 30-some years, right? Because now he wanted me to go on to maturity and to follow the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is a teacher. He teaches you the word. He teaches you wisdom and understanding. Then he guides you with the word. And then he convicts you of sin if you get off out of the word. And then he leads you to repentance, right? So there's the Holy Spirit now. If you love me, you'll obey me. Who could love God? Only those who receive Jesus. And if you obey me, then me and my Father come and make a home with him. So I believe the baptism of the Holy Spirit is a complete different experience from being born again, which you do have the Holy Spirit, but it's being filled with the Holy Spirit. So a lot of people think they have been filled with the Holy Spirit because they were born again. To them, so you have the Holy Spirit, there's no reference. Apollos was a good preacher. I talked about it Thursday. But Priscilla and Aquila told him and taught him the way of the word more accurately, and he received the Holy Spirit. Then Paul finds some disciples. And he said, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? They said, no, we only received the baptism of John. And he baptized him in the name of Jesus. He laid his hands on him, and he received the Holy Spirit, the community. So that's a different infilling of the Holy Spirit. So that's what you want to gauge. The person needs to listen to the Lord, and God supplies all your needs from his glorious riches, which are in heaven. So whether you either need the word of God, you need to be delivered from spirits, you need to be led by the Spirit, you need to be led to repentance, it's going to be done through the Holy Spirit. Because at one point when the Holy Spirit comes, you don't need anyone to teach you. So you're not trying to make a bunch of, in multi-level marketing, I'm not in it. Praise be to God. But in that, you need someone leading you, you know. You need someone encouraging you always because, you know, if you don't, that system falls to the ground and crashes. No, there's a time and a season. There's always time for fellowship. There's always the time for the moving of the Spirit with the gifts of the Spirit in the house of God, the church of God. But you don't need to be someone that's just constantly coddling someone. It breaks them. They don't mature correctly because they're void of the Holy Spirit. You become the Holy Spirit because you're teaching them the Word of God. You're encouraging them. You're showing them something. So they build an unhealthy relationship. I won't call it demonic soul tie. I wouldn't think that would be an adequate word. But it's an unhealthy relationship of them needing you when God is the one that they need. And so the deliverance is to allow you not to hear the voice of another, but the voice of God, and then to be led by the Spirit of God. Yeah. Now, you still need your friends, and praise God for them. You still need the body of Christ. You're supposed to be with them. You still need the gifts of the Holy Spirit used through men to constantly be built up according to your needs and a continual filling of the Holy Spirit. So before you can effectively eliminate negative thoughts, he said, you got to get delivered. If you can't stop them, by definition, you got to get rid of them. And if you want to get rid of them, and the demons are smart, they build a support network. Now, the support network can be other spirits. Like my brother said, they can be spirits that can move in the natural realm. But ultimately, they build their network for you to refuse to believe the truth for you. And so it was, well, I believe that, but no, once you said that, you're not believing it.
Right.
Either you believe it or you don't. Now you can wrestle with it. You can be like Brother Jarius, who had some help me with my unbelief. I do believe. But the minute you know something's true and you say, but now you're not going to get them out. Not the higher ones. You know, there's one, in my personal opinion, who I think is the original one. Just like God says, he sends angels to protect you. Well, Satan knew how the kingdom of God worked. He emulated it. So he had to work with demonic spirits, right? And they assign one to you, right? And I believe there's one who knows when he gets in there to build a network. He doesn't just get in there and say, I'm fine, I'm in here. He wants to build a network, and that network would go into operation even if you got saved. Because, hey, they're kicked out of the spirit. Your spirit is regenerated. You're no longer a natural man, but a spiritual man that can receive the promises of God. As a natural man, everything of God was foolish. But now you were translated into the truth of God, and the light's shining on you, on your spirit man. But now he's going to use your mind against you. He's going to use your emotions against you. He's going to use all the abuse and abandonment and belittlement and betrayal, violations. He's going to try to use it against you. So that's why he tries to hurt everybody. He tries to hurt everybody. And it's amazing how many people have hurt kids when they were kids. Just like I was saying, hey, I didn't know that bullying still existed. And obviously it's alive and well. Well, those words are hurting those children. Those words are ripping down who they are. Those words are a contradiction of what mom and dad has been instilling of who they are. It's a battle against what's been invested into them. So we got to be delivered from spirits. It's just how it works. But if you're just delivered from one manifestation, or backtracking a little bit, if the devil jumps in your deliverance and he says, you know what? You're not going to get delivered unless you get your husband right and he gets saved and you get what you once had. Or I'm not going to get delivered unless my children are saved. I don't deserve it. Or I'm not going to get delivered until all this infrastructure stops manifesting in the outside world. Then I won't be able to get what's in me. No, that's a lie. We start here. We got the authority here. And then through love, and through patience and wisdom, and through God's word, we can help our children, we can help our spouse, we can help other people. But it's got to start with us. And yeah, you go right to what you know, or what you can see that's negative in your life, what you can see that you want to do but can't do. When someone can't read the Bible and they're constantly tired, well, you better attack that, because you're not going to have faith unless you hear the word of God. And if you're constantly tired and you can't work and he's sucking all your energy, well, man, this has to be a spirit, because God came to give you life and life more abundantly, and you're 40 and you don't have any energy to do anything. That's contrary to the word of God. You better go against what you know, and that's fine. But then we have to, you know, really look at our life, you know, what our motivations are, what our intentions are, what are your true desires? Well, if they don't line up with being a disciple, we got to repent of that. We got to make a drift out of that and become a disciple. In Romans 16 or 6:16, do you not know that whoever you present yourselves slaves to obey, you are the ones slave that whom you obey? That's pretty easy for him to get in. I mean, if someone is a slave, he doesn't have a pestering spirit on his left shoulder, like they want to tell you through a cartoon. No, he's getting in, and he's giving you the mindset of a slave. He's giving you the actions of a slave. He says, whether it's sin leading to death or whether obedience leading to righteousness, but God be thanked that though you were slaves to sin, yet you obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine in which you were delivered. How you delivered? Through the biblical doctrine, through the sound interpretation of the word of God. That's how you're free. You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. If somebody just comes through, say, Win Worley, 1982, and you go down to Hedwig Baptist Church, and you're all on fire, well, man, he's going to call out everything from Pac-Man to karate, Hare Krishna and Buddha. He's going to call it all out in that afternoon, right? So these are spirits that would manifest in a certain way. But the problem is, there's a level of sin in your own life. Now, you might have manifested playing Pac-Man. I didn't know you could get demons from Pac-Man, but he cast it out. I proved you can get them from karate and cast them out of a little kid at Children's Deliverance one time, and he was throwing karate kicks and going crazy. Me and Mom were looking at it like, you got this for a six-year-old from karate? But say we're getting out karate, say we're getting out Pac-Man, whatever, But the reality is there are some spiritual forces that led you into these things, right? So now we kicked out of a spirit that was leading to a bad fruit, but now we got to go a little deeper, and that comes with you and Jesus, right? And what's a sign? Is slavery is you can't do what you want to do. Freedom is the ability to do what you want to do. Think good thoughts, believe for things, have hope in the things that God promised for the believers, to expect good people to come around you. As he said, you'd have a cloud of great witnesses. Things begin to multiply. And so we got to go back now, and we got to do something on our own. Thank you. Appreciate that. But God be thanks, you were once slaves to sin, yet obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which you were delivered. Having been set free from sin, you're now slaves of righteousness. So how do you gauge somebody that's truly delivered? He used to be a slave to sin in X, Y, and Z, but now he's a slave to righteousness, and now you see these good fruits. Yeah. So if you see anybody that's really plugged in here, and I just use them as references because those are the people I see all the time, So Jen, she's in here, and now I'm meeting people and say, yeah, I was told to come see you guys. My sister got help with Jen. You know, she's doing great, so I think this thing's real. You know, Julie has a class, and, you know, I think it was 38 people were here, you know, or 30-some people just on Tuesday, right? So there's okay, now when you're a slave to righteousness, there's fruits that you produce. When you were a slave to sin, man, we know what those fruits were. We fled from those. That's what we wanted freedom for. But on the flip side, going in the right direction, there's these good fruits. And so when you're truly surrendered to God, every Christian is going to bear good fruits. Every Christian. And from my 30 years of experience, the only Christians that I know the Word of God, they love God, but because they don't have any deliverance, they can't really bear good fruits on a regular basis. But from half my Christian life now, I've known about deliverance, and I can say everybody who loves God and everybody who wants to serve God, they can do it, and they do it effectively, and you can see the fruits. Anybody in here? I've heard of everybody's fruits. I've received encouragement from their lives. They come up with some nuggets that bring us to the next level. Like Julie said, hey, we're not knocking any of these ministers that didn't have it all right. But that's one of the benefits we have is being the Christians in the last hour. If that was the last hour, I forget what book that was in the New Testament. Said it is the last hour, and the end day started at the day of Pentecost when the Holy Spirit was poured out. We are in the last minutes. We now, as the last minutes army, get a glean from all these people. Amen. If you're low on energy, you should be able to plug into Isaiah Saldivar. He's like some kind of that Energizer Bunny. He got an Energizer Bunny boost in him. And man, he just goes and cranks. And you can get yourself a little energy. Frank and Ida Mae Hammond, he had great humility. He said, hey, I encourage anybody, go through some deliverance before they get there. I mean, that's humility to say that he was still working through this issue, that he didn't have it all. So he and his wife would cast out demons out of each other, and then someone would come in. I mean, if someone was coming in, I heard somebody roaring and chucking and puking, I'd get back in that car and head out the other direction. But that's because they didn't have any knowledge. He broke it down. He had all the fruits to show that system worked, right? So we got the opportunity to glean from all these guys, right? And so you hold fast to what's true, right? So territorial warfare, I would just say they didn't do it in the Bible. Jesus never did it. He never taught his disciples to do it. He prayed for certain things. That means he trusted God to deal with this realm here. But he gave the authority to us in our church. He gave the authority in our family. He gave the authority in our lives, right? Anything that was coming against you, yeah, you can bind those things, right? So now we're going to hold fast to what's true, what we can prove in the scriptures, right? So renewing your mind, most people think, well, this is just a, you know, yeah, we need to do this. No, this is the war. Right. This is the war, is to renew your mind. The war isn't people take Paul's, I beat my body down and I bring it into subjection that it would obey me. Well, that was symbology. He was saying, hey, I'm not punching the air. I'm not a boxer that's just a punching bag beater. I'm fighting for real. I'm bringing this body into subjection. He wasn't literally punching it. It was the thoughts. Nothing's ever done through your tongue that doesn't filter through your mind first. Nothing's done through your hands or feet that isn't filtered through your hands or through your head first. So the war with the thoughts are, you know, obviously God thoughts, devil thoughts, truth and lies, you know, good and evil. And then ultimately, the desire is he wants, either we're going to have hope or we're going to have hopelessness. Many people who come in here are they have a hopeless mentality. And that's a sign that I know, hey, you need some deliverance. And they'll say, well, you don't understand, I've been saved 48 years. You don't understand, man, I've been fighting these demons for 16 years straight, man. You don't understand, I do this stuff for 4 hours a day. Well, hey, you know, it always goes back to the basics. It's a war for these thoughts. And of course, these thoughts, now they're working with an arsenal of everything that was discouraging, everything that was a failure, everything that was disappointing. Those are their arsenal. Those are what they're working with so that when they do breach the truth and get a lie in there, now that's a weight. Man, if you had a bad day and the devil breaches your mind and gets a lie in there, now I got to feel the weight of every failure I did. That would be taxing because I've failed a bunch of times as a Christian, as a non-believer, knowing about deliverance, I failed all of it. I don't connect my daily failure with all that stuff, but people that are not free, they do. And you've got to get a person to disconnect their former life and all these failures from their current struggles.
Right.
It's not all tied together. That's what's called a chain. When it says that song that was real popular, break every chain. Well, that's the chain that the Bible's talking about, one that leads to all the weight of all your failures and disappointments and heartbreaks and your current struggles. And so you got to fight one battle at a time. You got to fight, you know, one thing at a time. It can't be, now I can't atone for all those sins. I can't make up for all those failures. They are what they are, and grace has to cover those. So it has to be a disconnection from all that. But in return, the battle is for hope. Hope, you hope for the things that you haven't seen yet, right? And there's evidence through faith and what God did for other people. He's not a respecter of persons. If he did it for them, we can get these things. But there's some things that we got to do. There's some mindsets that we had to have. And yes, there's some deliverance we have to experience as well. Because if you're hopeless, man, that's going to be a very sad Christian life. There's going to be hard to have joy if you're hopeless, right? You got a question?
I just was curious about limitations on intercession, being an intercessor for your loved ones, the loss that you're dealing with them, and they're, you know, either mocking you or discouraging you, or you're dealing with you see in your spirits, like, stuff. Like, how much can you, like, find lose, like, and really kind of, like, counter, like, deal with what, you know, and try to hope that they are free one day. The Lord
calls them out. Okay, well, I see our role biblically is the only thing that once they're adults, like they're kids, you can just go ahead and kick them demons out, right? But once they're adults, once they're the age of accountability, now they got to make decisions as an adult, right? They have to repent. So I don't have authority to be binding any of their demons unless they want freedom, right? And so yes, it's only prayer. You know, you just pray for them, right? And there's people you got to cut off, people that won't change. You know, you can't be around this negativity. You got to let them go. Sometimes you can't let them go because your financial situations and or you're a caretaker, whatever the situation might be. But we pray for them. But you have to have faith in your prayers. So a way the devil confuses people that know about deliverance is he wants to make everything spiritual to the level where you you're wrong for not fixing it. You need to cast them out. You need to root them out, drive them out. You know, you need to operate in authority. They shouldn't do that to you. That devil's attacking you through them. Well, the problem is any demon that's manifesting through someone is because they have a hardness to them. And the devil speaks through that hardness. One of the manifestations of no love for someone is they tell you hateful things, right? And so we're praying that God would get to their heart, you know, and if they're doing things, they say, well, I'm not hard. I do love you. Well, then they're blind. I'm going to pray that they could see, right? And so this world's tough, and there's repercussions to sin, right? And it's in your own household sometimes. But we got the authority here. I believe that when we get more refined, then you can pray good prayers according to the Word of God that you believe for God to go into operation. And then you don't have to operate to fix those people. Not saying you're doing that, but that's one of the things that praying according to the Scripture and believing it, that God will go to work, right? And so there are times you got to just step back with people. It's just the way it works. There are sometimes you got to just cut people off and get out of Dodge. And I know there are times where you can't for whatever reason, but we don't have authority to just be binding them because they're just going to keep manifesting on you because they can do whatever they want. They have free will. If they want demons, they can have demons. Even if you did kick them out for a minute, hey, then they might be able to go get seven more wicked than themselves, and you could be building up their arsenal of more demons because they got an open door. The house is swept clean and in order. Jesus ain't in control. If they're ripping people down and insulting people, that Jesus isn't speaking through them. A voice is speaking through them. So those thoughts, became their actions, and now those are their deeds, right? They got that free will. I don't have the authority to root out all that. But if they're our children, we do. So, and then, you know, there's some discernment, and I'm not the best at this, but love changes things, right? Loving people. Being able to get to a level of a servant, it's hard to constantly trample over. I was kind of a ornery type person. But one time, I didn't really get to defending too many people. I thought, hey, this is your day. Learn to man up and take it. But man, one thing I just felt bad if someone would say, man, guys, man, you're tearing me up inside, man. I'm feeling bad. And kind of have a half smile. And I'm like, man, this is a happy person, man. Why would we want to go and do that to that guy? Here I'm neck deep in sin. We're drinking. We're doing whatever we're doing. But I had just a respect of, man, he's got some joy, and it ain't in our weed like us. It ain't in our bottle that we just drank. Why would you want to mess with that, right? So even sinful people have a hard time stomping on love. So love is powerful. And then love gives you an opportunity to speak to a person at a level they won't let you in unless you've loved them, right? And so I know all that takes timing and discernment, and I don't know your exact details, but hopefully some of those are the things that'll help you. But just going ahead and binding their demons certainly doesn't sound like it got better, and I can prove it won't be better because I've been seeing the fruits of that for many years. All right, here's the theme of my message here. And we'll hit this hard and we'll pray. But this is 2 Corinthians chapter 10. You all know it, but we'll break it down a little bit more in detail. This is your go-to helping people and how it works. 2 Corinthians 10, 3 through 6. Though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. It says this, so for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God. And he gives you five things that they do. Number one is pulling down strongholds. That's the infrastructure behind things. A demon is smart. Once he gets in there, he's not happy. Just, well, go look at a meth addict, for example. Now that's a level 10 sinner. A meth addict is not just a meth addict. Now, weed addict, man, he might just smoke pot, go to the dispensary, and go to work. And but a meth addict is a different person. He's got a lying spirit up in there. And the lying spirit operates in him. They can pass lie detector tests because they lie to themselves as well as they lie to other people. And then it takes some thievery to keep that operation going. And a bunch of thieves are in that lifestyle, so they're going to be real around it. So he's going to have a lying and a thieving spirit, and then they almost all become perverts, big time perverts. And from my experience, I can't say all, but it's the major majority. So now that thing has such an infrastructure around it, right? Well, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty in God for pulling down the strongholds. Oh, God's giving you eyes to see. If you want to get off meth, you better get rid of that lying devil. You want to get rid of that meth demon, you better get away from stealing. You want to get away from that meth devil, you better get away from perversion. And I've seen it before. I've seen a guy was certified mentally ill. No, he was certified disabled, and he got a check from the government for the rest of his life from his deteriorated back. He got healed in here. He got off meth. He got off cigarettes. And the devil got back into meth. I said, how did this happen? He goes, man, when I do this meth, I'm only with my wife, but man, we have intimacy on a level that's uncomparable if I'm not on this meth. And I just wanted that with my wife. And he smoked the meth. So the infrastructure, he had got rid of the thieving. He wasn't really injured. He just knew how to hustle that system and gave the money back for the rest of his life. He got rid of the meth itself, but he didn't get rid of the perversion, and it came back and brought the whole system back. So you got a powerful weapon from God. It's a spiritual weapon to take down spiritual forces. So he's telling you, take out of your natural mind. Now, we renew this natural mind according to the Word of God, and the Word of God is spirit and it's life. It's in this natural mind, but I'm taking away all my natural thoughts. Most Christians have natural thoughts. My brother is studying. He's a John MacArthur follower. He's got a doctorate in John MacArthurism, version of Christianity, and he's a strong Christian. I mean, they're studying the Word, but there's these things where now he's studying to be a counselor, and he goes, hey, you deal with people that see demons? I'm like, yeah, there's a lot of people that see demons. He goes, you know, and he gives me this scientific statistic. If a person doesn't sleep after 24 hours, there's a chemical that's developed in your brain that's similar to LSD, and you can literally hallucinate. And he goes, so you better ask those people that are seeing demons how much sleep they get. So in his mind, when he's learning, it's almost like a spirit. And he's a good man of God. He's a street preacher. He leads a lot of people to Jesus. When he gets to heaven, man, he's going to be right with God, right? But these spirits that come from natural men teach the Word of God and break it down with human reasoning. Right? So he's thinking no one really sees demons. I'm like, well, okay. And I didn't get into it. Like, no, they see this one and he comes down in the day and chokes them until they gasp for air, until they call for Jesus. Then they breathe. And he's been coming around since they were five. Right? I don't tell them all that, right? Because it's just one perspective, but then it's almost like a blanket coverage for everybody that's seen demons. And you can't do that. Are there some people probably seeing some shadow figures because they hadn't slept? Well, sure. And I don't deal with manifestations because you see shadow figures. I deal with manifestations of sin, and we repent of sin. And then when you have tried and you can't stop it, well, now we know there's a spiritual force behind it. So though we walk in this flesh, we're not thinking fleshly, we're not reasoning fleshly, we're understanding spiritually because we have the Word of God, which is spiritual, and we're making a spiritual warfare. And we have spiritual power in these weapons to pull down strongholds. Strongholds are the wall of resistance in the mind. They're blockers from the truth. So if a person can't receive truth, by definition, they have a stronghold. Before something became a stronghold, it first came in with lies, and then it had a hold. Then it got a position of authority, which is a stronghold. And you got to be able to pull that down so you can get some truth in there. There's no sense of continuing to casting and casting out a person, and you've met with them 10 times for one-on-ones, and they still believe lies. You need to make a copy of that miracle list, and you need to tell them to do it. And then if you ask them if they did it, and they say no, you need to encourage them and pray for them to do the parts of which they can't do so they can overcome with truth. Don't overcome evil with evil, but overcome evil with good. Doing the Word of God is good, and it's going to help you. Then it says casting down arguments. Those are thoughts and patterns. So when we have a spiritual weapon that came from God to not wrestle against flesh, but against these principalities and powers, rulers of darkness, spiritual hosts of wickedness, these are the infrastructure and the trainers of the demons that get into the body. Well, we got to cast down their arguments. They'll try to argue in your own mind. They'll tell you why you can't get delivered. They'll keep trying to get you to find a more anointed deliverance minister. I was delivered from the most powerful spirit I had that was going to make me a multi-millionaire, which it made all my friends but one. And he was already a Christian, so it couldn't work. And it came out with a guy that never had cast out a demon out of no one. And he put his hand on me because I was growling, because I was repenting of lying to make money. And he put his hands on me. He said, in the name of Jesus, and he couldn't think of another thing to pray because he was stunned, and that's all it took for that demon to leave.
Amen.
Because I was already repenting, and God already told me all liars go to hell. And then he opened my eyes to say, you lie all the time. Well, in my mind, you were a liar if you lied about things that you said you did and you didn't do. You lied about things that you wish you had. But if you lie to get money, that's just business, right? In this business. I justified it. No, anything that's not the truth is a lie. And that was a spiritual force that came out. That thing, my insides shook and it left. No coughing, no hacking, no puking, no buckets. It, boom! It went in the name of Jesus. So if you're going to get someone free, it isn't the power of the deliverance minister. It's the power that he has inside of him. It's he who is in us is greater than he who is in the world. The word of God is powerful. It's sharper than a two-edged sword. We're working with the keys to success is the God's word. He said it and he'll do it. You haven't seen it, and I hate to tell you, it falls on you. It never falls on God, it falls on you. Because there's something you haven't been able to see, there's something you haven't been able to hear, or there's something you can't understand, or something that made you surrender to accept it. So first one was pulling down strongholds. Second one was casting down arguments. Those were the thoughts and the patterns. And every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Those are the priorities. There's some things the devil will put in a person that it will exalt itself. I saw a guy, this guy rolled up here in a $120,000 pickup truck. That's what it cost off the lot before he put these big rims and suspension system on there. And he was losing his mind. Career porn watcher, been watching it since he was a teenager. And he goes, why can't I feel God anymore? I've went to places that they can't help me at my church. And I'm here, can you cast this out? I said, yeah, I can cast it out. Tries to take my hand and put it on his hand, like, cast it out then. And I don't want this anymore. And I said, well, look, I got to tell you some things. You've been serving two masters. You've been listening to demons and then having Bible studies. God was so gracious, he'd meet you in the Bible studies. He loved you. You did get born again. There you were having an encounter with your spirit man. Over here you were having encounters with the demons in your flesh. He goes, okay, I don't want that anymore. I haven't done it in 2 weeks. I said, look, man, just be patient here. And long story short, I couldn't get any demons out of him. And I said, well, look, man, if you'll do this miracle list, if you go over these checklists of things biblically that we found that are key and essential to you getting delivered, you can get delivered on Thursday. Oh, I can't come Thursday. Well, can you come Friday? Friday, Michael, be here. Oh, I can't come Friday, man. I'm going up north. We got a trip up there. We got a cabin and we're going up north. You know, it's the kids' break. And I'm thinking, you're losing your mind and you're literally... He's got a good job, made buku money, and he was just came from the nut house. They institutionalized him for 3 days, and you need a vacation, and you're worried about what your kids are going to think because they're on spring break or whatever it was, and they need this little vacation. Dad ain't going to be a good dad, and dad ain't going to be around for the next vacation unless you get these things out. They're coming for full go now. They've got enough demons in there to think they can take your mind and wipe you out. Well, you got to take spiritual weapons to do a warfare against a spirit like that, that it got to that level where it acknowledged, it exalted itself above the knowledge of God. He couldn't discern that he needed to put this deliverance before a 3-day vacation to Heber. And in return, I never saw him again. I don't know what happened to the guy. He probably left thinking I was a bozo and couldn't get his demons out. Number four is bringing every thought into captivity and to the obedience of Christ. It's a spiritual weapon to begin to do it. I know that's true, Brother Rick. I know that's true, but it just ain't going right. Look at this, 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 and this. And they give me a four-banger reason why they can't do something that's scripture. Well, they're not using their spiritual weapon. You're not wrestling against flesh and blood. You're wrestling against a spiritual force. You're wrestling against a person. And that person most likely has people up there supporting them, working against you in your own mind and body. So you need a spiritual weapon for pulling down, bringing every thought rather into captivity. No, I got you now. I know you're a lie. That devil ever tries to get me on pornography, I got him as a lie. I said, man, he'll try to make, and I by the grace of God, I got victory over that coming in here 15 years ago, that what it would do is make me think anything sexual. Like, man, I can't have a fat gut. Someone might look at me and I'm not sexually appealing. Hey, I might need a hair transplant because I'm not sexy enough with a receded hairline. Thoughts were captive. Those spirits talked to me about the way I looked, about the way people would perceive me, and therefore he talked to me about all kinds of things, about having riches and having all this success so that you have value. You eliminate the sexual perversion demon and a lot of that stuff crumbles. So a lot of your deliverance is off one thing that he's working in your life. But if you allow him to be in there, well, people have told me things like, you don't understand, Brother Rick, my wife can't keep up. I've heard women even say, my husband can't keep up. I have a very high sex drive. And I'm like, no, they're hyper-accentuating your sexual desires where you're not satisfied in the parameters in which God gives you, or there's a dissatisfaction with what God gives you, so he's telling you to look somewhere else to meet those satisfactions that he put in you. But no, it's not. You're just highly sexually charged. This is a spirit that is overriding your natural desires. And I've proven that to be true with people who get delivered. It goes back into normal, and then God reveals the best was always with your spouse. It wasn't anywhere else. That was full of guilt. That was full of lies. And yeah, there was some extra on methamphetamines and doing things illicitly, there was a bunch of endorphins, dopamine rushes, but hey, that would never satisfy. That only led for more and more lawlessness. So you gotta bring every thought into captivity in obedience to Christ. Every thought. Now, devil tries to say anything about that, man, I shun it. I got my whole, everything's based on algorithms, man, and all my algorithms to any of the YouTube shorts or Facebook shorts is Bible verses, because that's all I look at over and over again. I know you got to scroll fast if there's a little something inappropriate as a something. They'll even gauge if you scrolled slowly. They'll give you another one to scroll, see if you scroll a little slower. Those things are trying to get you to look at things, right? So I've retrain my mind, and I've retrained my social media. I've retrained where I go and the things that I listen to people talk about. And so I'm able to take those thoughts captive and obedient. Why? Because I'll fight for obedience, because I know obedience is good. I know obedience fulfills you and satisfies you. Sin doesn't. You had a question back there?
Yeah, I just want to add on to what I was asking for episode of an incident that happened with both of my daughters last year. For my youngest, I'm driving late at night from a trip. She grabs my arm, and what I know, it wasn't her, it was the demons in her, and they were trying to transfer spirits in me, and I knocked out, and I came back too, and I realized I could take my arm back, and I'm like, you know, they were trying to take us out, and something like that. And I looked at her, and I saw, you know.
Is your daughter a methamphetamine addict?
Nope.
She a witch?
Nope.
She has that kind of power in her to download demons by grabbing arms? Wow.
I just know that I was just driving, all of a sudden, and then I'm like,
where do you think she got that kind of demonic power?
I don't know. I know that my family's been under heavy duty attack.
Well, the attack, they're already in there. They're doing attacking through them.
I lost them, and I did my best to raise these kids.
Well, I would work on yourself, and you get some more discernment, but I've never personally heard of that. That someone that's not a math addict or a witch that could grab someone's arm and download those type of spirits.
In the family line.
Well, one thing you got to fight from a position of faith. If they got you beat down, okay, Mike Tyson was the greatest fighter in the history of the world, in my opinion. But before he lost to a journeyman fighter, Buster Douglas, he said he was sleeping with 9 prostitutes and they were feeding him grapes like he was Adonis, the Greek god. Well, he got knocked out by a journeyman, the greatest, because what? He didn't fight from his full potential, right? Now, spiritually, it works the same way. If you come in here and you're a victim and you've lost, you want to fight these demons, you're not going to get out the strong ones. You better fight from a position of faith. You better fight from a position and click in. You can't look at your natural situation when you click into a fight. A lot of people have never been in a fist fight, but you've been in a fist fight, boy, you're all hands on deck. You don't underestimate someone. You bring what you got, especially in a bar fight, because you can get your teeth knocked out, curb stomp, jump. It's rough, right? Well, you're in a fight with Satan. You need to, in 20 minutes here, 10 minutes, we go to prayer time. You need to fight, not from a position of weakness and those chains of every bad thing that's happened to you. You need to fight with what you got right now. You have faith. You have the word of God. There'll be a corporate anointing here, and you can piggyback off us ministers' anointing and fight from a position of faith. Don't come at this as someone that's been bashed and from a long line of hurts and pains and witches and what life. Turn in for that time. 15, 20 minutes of prayer, cast out time. You go full on with what you got because it's a fight. And there will only be one winner, so let's go for all of them. Let's not make a 3-year plan for your deliverance. So let's make a 30-minute plan and get rid of them tonight, today. Pulling down strongholds, we war. And we have weapons for pulling down the stronghold, casting down arguments, taking every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, then bringing every thought into captivity, meaning that's not Bible. That's not Bible. That's not scripture, right? You bring it into obedience to Christ. Number 5, and then being ready to punish all disobedience. So you're putting to death now the misdeeds of the body. And it says, when your obedience is fulfilled. So how are we going to be able to fulfill all this? Is when we choose to be obedient. For the sake of time, we'll stop it there. There were some good questions. We got a good 30, 40 minutes of questions. So that was good. Going into our prayer time. It's a small group setting. There's an anointing in this building. The women and the men that pray for this ministry, they pray for all the meetings. We're going to be able to piggyback off that. Thousands of people have came through over the years, and they care about Christians. They care about people like you that are coming here to be free. And God wants you free, but we can't get free off lies. We can't get free if we're victims. We can't get free if the devil's stronger than the Holy Spirit. And because as a man thinks, so is he. He's going to try to tell you anything he can tell you. He loves people to forever learn, but never come to the knowledge of the truth. He wants you forever learning about deliverance, but never ever able to get delivered. Well, if we're going to get delivered, we're going to get delivered from strongholds. We're going to get delivered from arguments. Those are the thoughts and patterns. We're going to have to get delivered from things that exalted, priorities that exalt themselves against the will of God, the knowledge of God. And then we're going to have to daily take thoughts captive and obedient to Jesus. And then we need to punish all disobedience. We got to put to death the misdeeds of the body. It's hard to do it, especially when you've been doing it for 20 years. But it's not a suggestion, it's a mandate, right? And some people, it can be as simple as God tricks people into thinking that he wants you to be poor. But the problem with that mindset is then those people struggle. And instead of encouraging people and being able to give to other people, they need the church constantly to help them bail them out of debt. And then almost like they go in, they get a car, and then the doubt just starts, oh, how am I going to make this payment? Oh, no. And everything even that they get from God becomes a burden. So it's not about health and wealth and the word of faith. I'm not talking about any of that stuff. I'm talking about poverty mindsets. And there's also a financial poverty mindset. There's also a spiritual poverty mindset. And where people just say, well, this is all I've ever known is to be demonized. All I've ever known is to be discouraged. All I've ever known is to be lustful. Well, you got to understand that the Holy Spirit makes all things new.
Amen.
Now, it hasn't been made new because by definition, that's a stronghold. He's got a hold on you and he's got a supporting cast up there. And you got to start tearing him down. And you do it with a spiritual weapon. Spiritual weapons are your faith. What overcomes the world? Our faith. You believe that God wants you free. You believe the word of God is a sword, that it can cut off sin that so easily entangles, that Jesus is a chain breaker. Chains are the things that, yeah, I got a problem, and then it's connected with every one of your problems and failures. You could have that chain broken. Now, I go deal with life like every other human, but I can deal with one issue at a time. I can deal with one struggle at a time. I can overcome one thing at a time. That's life, and you're going to continue to do that. Some people have a delusion that once you get delivered, you're on easy street. No, you're able to deal with one thing at a time, and you're able to do it biblically. You're able to do it with the soundness of your mind. You're able to then use the power of God when it's time to use the power of God. You're navigated by the word of God. And then as you get free, God will put a hedge of protection around you, literally. Where there's negative voices that just can't get in my head. They don't come in my house. They don't come to my mind anymore. There's things that just doesn't come to my house. There's things I'm not tempted with anymore. And hey, there's some things that try to barge in. There's some things that I subject my eyes to that I should have been more diligent, that allow some more thought, intrusive thought. It's a battle, but there's a protection. You don't have to live in this complete whirlwind of hell, this full whirlwind of fighting the devil at every single direction. You can get up on your feet. You can have some rest. You can have some security for the eternal life because of the scriptures. You can, these things I've written, that you would know that you have eternal life. There's people that literally are going through deliverance at the level that they don't think they're saved when they sin and then when they mess up. No. You can stand firm on the things that God have written, that you're saved by grace through your faith. This isn't of yourself. It was a gift from God. He loves you. He wants to help you. A smoldering wick by no means will he snuff out. He's not going to snuff you out. He's for you. He's trying to help you. God is good. But what we need to do right now, and I say how we go into this prayer, is you got to go back a little bit. But let's not go back to yesterday or last week. Let's go back when things started going bad. And when I look, when things started going bad is when I wasn't content with things. Things were going good in high school. I was playing football. I had some good friends. But there was something pushing me where I wanted to be around another group of friends. And they were drinking and they were smoking pot. It came down to I wasn't content. I wasn't happy with everything. There was something that just had a burning desire for more. And then it led me to this life of just constantly open up doors that would intrigue me no matter what the consequences would be. It led me to lawlessness. And so it really, one of the things, backtracking, there was some ungratefulness in me. Ungratefulness will open some really nasty doors in your life. And once they're open, even though you get saved, they'll manifest when things don't go your way as a Christian. Sometimes it's perversion. Sometimes perversion was let into you because someone violated you sexually. It's not everybody was raped and molested, but there's so many women that said, hey, I had no intentions whatsoever to get involved with a sexual relationship with this person, but their constant persuasion, their constant manipulation and desires for this, I slowly was coerced to surrender And then it led me into a constant sense of not worthy. And I kept going into the same relationships with the same type of people. Well, going back, it was a spirit. It was a spirit that came in to make you a slave. Well, before you would be a slave to sin, you became a slave to people that were motivated by sinful desires. Sometimes you have no respect for anybody. So it's hard for you to learn in the church of God. It's hard for you to have a mentor because deep down you don't respect anybody. Well, it comes down to sometimes when you go back where people were hypocrites. And those hypocritical people hurt you, and you suffered because of their hypocrisy, whether it was a family member, or it was somebody at the church, whether it was someone at your job. And in return, a spirit got in your head because of the pain, and through the pain, he told you, you can't trust anybody, and no one's worth listening to, and that's now a stronghold. And now you have a hard time at church, you have a hard time in the men's group or the women's group. Sometimes you weren't anything in life and you always wanted to be something. And then when you got saved, the Spirit told you to take off on a race, that you were something special, which you are. But you were special now and you didn't need to listen to anybody else. And you were going to be your own instructor. And now you're out there on your own and you keep running into all these demons wherever you go. And there's no protection around you. Because you took off running and you didn't have enough patience to spend time with Jesus and really discern his voice, and you keep being led astray. And he tells you good things, but he gets you out there on your own power. And this devil even masquerades as an angel of light. You have to be real. If your Christian life is met dead end upon dead end and very few fruits, you have to make an honest evaluation if you've been following the Lord's voice or the voice of another. And I'm not telling you that you don't have the Holy Spirit. I'm not telling you that you're not saved. I'm just telling you the Spirit comes in sometimes because he wants you to run on your own power. And you had a new identity as a man and a woman of Christ when you got born again. And there was a significance. There was a genuine adoption. And you were a son and a daughter of Christ. But he wanted you to run now to atone and let everybody see that you're a Christian now, and you're significant. You're not that weak-willed woman. You're not that insignificant man. It's devil's doing it. Because Christians have to be patient. You Christians have to be kind. And one of the fruits is now you've lost a little love for people when they don't listen to everything you say. And you disregard pastors when you send them emails or try to correct them. So let's look at ourselves. Lord, thank you, Holy Spirit, that we can come to you and we can take a look at our lives. And Lord, we can wage a war according to what is a stronghold. What is an intrusive thought? What is a voice of another? And Lord, we want to be free, Lord. And it is true that if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. And the second part is the old things pass away. And behold, all things become new. Lord, we're interested in that new life. We're interested in letting go of all the guilt and the shame and the poor self-worth, the condemnation, the sinful activity, Lord. And thank you that you gave us a spiritual weaponry for a spiritual war. Thank you, Lord, for this power. Tonight, or rather this afternoon, I confess my sins, Lord. I'm sorry, Lord. I'm sorry for not being patient. I'm sorry for not being kind, Lord. I'm sorry for getting ahead of you, Lord, and following the voice of another. Please forgive me, Lord, for the people that I hurt, the people that I disrespected, the people that I disregarded. You called me into the people business, Lord. And I'm sorry for the way I've treated everybody, Lord. In Jesus' name, Lord, I'm forgiving them. I'm forgiving all these people, Lord. I've been taking a lot of abuse. I've been taking a lot of garbage, Lord. Even people's demons, I've been taking them, Lord. I forgive them, Lord. I'm not going to operate with fear. I'm not going to operate with hatred towards them anymore. I'm going to be able to bless and not curse. I'm going to be able to pray and believe for them, Lord. So I forgive them in Jesus' name. I do want to help people, Lord. I do want to preach the good news and make disciples of all nations. I do, Lord, want to lay hands on sick people and see them recover. I do, Lord, want to cast out demons. But Lord, I know that I got to get rid of all these evil spirits out of myself. So thank you, Lord, for sending the Holy Spirit power to me right now. I'm going to fight not as a victim. I'm going to fight as a son. I'm going to fight as a daughter. I'm going to fight with the expectation of complete victory right now in Jesus' name. Satan, you're bound. I bind your power in Jesus' holy name. I'm tired of you. I'm tired of you harassing me. I'm tired of you harassing my family. I'm tired of you downloading your spirits into me. I'm not going to be your spiritual pincushion in Jesus' name. I'm not going to take no for an answer when God's holy word says yes. I command you in the name of Jesus to let me go. I'm uprooting this shame. I'm not living in this shame. I'm tired of this chain that connects me with all my certain battle or certain failure with all my failures. I break that chain in Jesus' holy name. I break that chain. I break these voices in my mind. I'm not listening to your voice anymore. I know what's behind that voice is you, Satan. You are an evil person. You are an evil person. I'm commanding you in the name of Jesus to come out of there. I'm commanding you to come out of there right now. Take a big breath. Come out of there right now. All those religious spirits, I'm commanding you to come out. All those religious spirits, I'm commanding you to come out. I am not a witchcraft victim. I'm not a witchcraft victim. Come out of there in Jesus' name. I am not mentally ill. Come out of there right now. My future is not the state hospital. Come out of there right now. My future is not depression. My future is not poverty. Come out of there right now. That spirit that was blinking, we're coming for the one that was blinking. In the name of Jesus, the one that was blinking, that was behind his forehead, behind his eyes, I command you to come out. Come out of there right now. The one that was blinking behind his eyes, I command you, stop doing that. Stop blinking behind his eyes. Stop that right now. We got authority over this one right now that is affecting my eyes, affecting the way that I think. You come out right now. You tell him, you come out right now. You come out right now. I want you out of my mind. Fight only him. Don't fight the ones manifesting on bikes and appearing out of nowhere. Fight only the one that was messing with your eyes. In the name of Jesus, come out of there right now. Come out of there. Any spirit blocking my anointing, you have to come out. Any spirit speaking to me, even mimicking God, I bind your power. I'm commanding you to come out. I'm commanding any religious spirit to come out of there right now. Come out of there right now. Religious spirits, come out of there right now. Come out of there right now. Religious obligations and religious performance, come out of there right now. Come out of there right now. I'm commanding you to come out. You've made me bitter. Come out right now. You've made me double-minded. I'm commanding you to come out. I'm commanding you to come out. I want the bitterness in my body. Get that poison out of there. That bitterness, I command you to come out. Sickness, come out of there right now. I want the sickness out of his body. Come out right now. You told him he was going to die soon. You're a liar. You told him to fear cancer. Come out of there right now. Come out of there. Come out of there. I fight you from a position of power. Thank you, Lord, that this man's not depressed. There's a lie that came into his mind that made him depressed. I command you to come out right now in Jesus' name. Come out, the spirit of heaviness. The spirit of heaviness, I command you to be broken in Jesus' name. The spirit of heaviness, come out. Jesus said, come to me, all you who are heavy laden. Come to me, for my burden is light and my yoke is easy. You'll find rest for your soul. Just come to him, my friend. Lord Jesus, I welcome you in. The key to my success is Jesus. The key to my success is the Holy Ghost power. Oh, when I've been saved, the victory has already been won. For this man was purchased through the blood of Jesus Christ. Thank you that he's found in you. I'm found in you, Lord. There's something to be joyous about today. There's something to have a sense of victory today because my name is in the book of life. Thank you, Jesus, for this blessed assurance. Thank you, Jesus. Now come out of there. Come out of my mind. Come out. I'm taking those thoughts captive. You told me I wouldn't be delivered. You told me I wouldn't be successful. You told me not to believe for miracles. I'm taking those thoughts captive in Jesus' name. Take a big breath. Just let it go. You can let it go. You can let it go. in the name of Jesus, the Son of God. I come against all those spirits that talked to her over all those years that her value was always based on her performance. Her value was based on what she could produce or what she looked like. Oh, devil, you're a liar. Her value comes from the Lord Jesus. Oh, and all those gifts were deposited by God as a gift. And those gifts were given for His glory. Now you come out of there right now. Come out of there right now. Anger and frustration at herself. Sense of not being good enough. Not being good enough to move in miraculous power. Come out right now. Come out right now, that carnal mind. That carnal mind, that carnal expectation for the things of God. I command you to be broken. I command any spirit working with another spirit to separate yourselves now in Jesus' name. Come out of there. Come out of there right now. Just take two coughs right from here. He'll come out of there. Just two big coughs. He'll go. Come out of there, you choker. Come out of there, you choker. Come out. You're choking her faith. Come out of there. You're choking her joy. I'm commanding you to come out right now. Worrying about getting older, worrying about getting sick. No, you come out of there. Though the outward appearance of man perishes, the inward man's being renewed day by day. She's actually getting stronger. Come out of there, devil. Come out of there right now. Come out of there right now. Come out of there right now. You devouring spirit that takes her strength. Come out right now. Come out of there right now. Stealing the strength of Jesus. Come all the way out. 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 All the hurts from men. All the hurts from women. Every word they spoke, going all the way back to her adolescence and childhood when they tore her down. Come out right now. Come out right now. Even those words that were told by people to build her up, and devil, you pulled the rug out from under her. Come out right now. Come out of there. Come all the way out. You got him. You got him going. Keep fighting him. Keep fighting him. They'll all come out. Come out of there right now. Sir, take a big cough. Get this thing moving. Just use your faith. Come out of there. I don't want you choking me. I don't want you choking me anymore. Come out of there. I got joy, and I got the joy of the Lord, and I got the right as a son of God to have the joy. That's my source of strength. You come out of there. There you go. Get him out. He's a joy stealer. That's the one you're going for. There you go. Joy stealer. Get out of there in Jesus' name. Keep going, brother. Keep going. Keep going. Come out of there. I'm not picking up anyone's demons anymore. I'm not picking up anyone's demons anymore. I don't care who touches me. I don't want no demons, and I'm not a conduit. I'm not a sponge for demons. I'm not a sponge for demons. That's over. I'm not a sponge for these things. Come out of there. I want the spirit of gloom to come out right now. Come out. Hope does not disappoint because the love of God has been poured out into our heart through Christ Jesus the Lord. Come out of there right now. I want the disappointment spirit to come out. Come out. I know you're a spirit. Come out. Come out of there right now. I want that spirit of disappointment to come out now. I want the spirit of disappointment to come out right now. Come out of there right now. The love of God gives us the power to believe. Come out of there right now. Come out of there. Come out of there now. Come out of there. Come all the way out of there. Come all the way out of the couple of God. Fear about ministry. Come out of there. Fear about ministry. Come out. Fear that things won't get better. No, there is a hedge of protection around the man and the woman of God. And in the hedge of protection, oh, things get filled up. Needs get filled up and satisfied. Joy gets filled up and satisfied. Oh, miracles get filled up and manifest into healings. Come out of this, woman of God. Come out of this, woman of God. Come out of there right now. You're a generational spirit of devouring. You went into operation to devour her joy as a woman of God. I'm commanding you to come out. Come out. I know you're on these shoulders. You're a weight of heaviness. I'm commanding you to come out. I'm commanding you to come out. Come out. Come out. Come out. You're trying to make her see things in the negative light. Come out right now. Come out. You got a negative lens. You got a negative window. Oh, you're blocking her from the good things. You're blocking her from the blessings. You're blocking her from the joy. You're blocking her from the healings. I'm commanding you to come out. Come out of there. Come out of that body. I'm letting it go now. Oh, we've all failed. Today I let it go. The failures, the things I can't fix. I'm turning it over to the Lord. He's the only one that can fix it. He's the only one that can fix it. He's the only one that can fix this pain that comes upon me at times. Come out of there. Come out of there. Oh, the pain. You've even told her she might get sick. You're a liar. She shall live and prosper and be in good health. You have to go. You have to go. Just take two coughs. He'll come out. He'll go. Come all the way out. Come all the way out. Come all the way out. Release all the way out of the bones. Release all the way out of the bones. Release all the way out. Release all the way out. Release. Release. Go. Go. Come out of the throat. Stop blocking the deliverance. Stop blocking the deliverance. Stop blocking the deliverance. Stop blocking the deliverance. Go. Oh, I want all of them out. Streamers. You can get all of them out. Take a big breath. All that shame that came in when she was 12. Oh, you stick around trying to nitpick her, trying to fault find her, trying to criticize her. I root you out going all the way back when she was young. I root you all the way out. For the Lord gives a satisfaction to a believer. He gives a satisfaction and a sense of reward when they do the things that are pleasing to Him. Devil, you'll never be satisfied. I bind this one, this spirit of dissatisfaction. I'm commanding you in the name of Jesus to come out of there. Come out of the mind. Come out of the emotions. That little whisper that always says, things are good now, but it won't last long. You are a voice. Come out, big breath. Get Him out of there. Big breath. Get up out of there right now. I want this spirit of sickness to come out of my body. My body's not as strong as it used to. It's not working like it used to. And you're telling me it's because my age. Devil, I want you out. He'll live long and prosper. Come out right now. He will live long and prosper. He forgave himself from dishonoring his mother and father. Come out right now. Sickness and fatigue. Come out of there right now. Sickness and fatigue. Come out. We're not listening to your voice. We're not listening to your voice. Come out of there right now. I send away your fatigue. Come out right now. I send away any ill effects on this body. I take authority over any spirit that would try to put cancer in this body. I come against any cancerous cell, any tumor, any aneurysm. I'm commanding you to go. I'm commanding you to go. Hey, bro, what do you think your, sir, what do you think your problem is? What's going on with you?
Since 8/2018, but it does have control over my mind. I've renewed my mind in the name of Jesus. If you put His name in front of your face, you dwell on it, concentrate on it, stay on it. His name, if those lighting negative thoughts pop like a balloon, I do it every day. I get pounded with it, but I put His name right there.
So what's the problem? He's messing with what since 2018? What's he messing with?
More physical torment.
What, something's wrong with your body? What do you mean physical? Like something's touching you? What are you saying?
Touching, yeah. It doesn't stop the ministry.
I know, but what, we can get rid of what's tormenting you. That's what we're talking about. What's he doing to you?
Right now, he's not really, he's really backed off a lot because of the name of Jesus. But at the beginning, he tried to break my leg. He said, put pressure on my Adam's apple to cut off my breathing. That was at the beginning. Sleep paralysis. It's like it's, whatever he's handed me wore out. It doesn't come back.
Oh, good.
He's wearing out of options.
What's he got left that we can fight right now?
Nothing left. He's nothing? Go. There's nothing. No
food. Well, what would be a symptom to say, let's check?
Nightmares.
What's your first name?
Jerry. I've met you before.
Yeah. Gary. Heavenly Father, let's,
the thing,
let's pray
the thing
for
about
them.
With the nightmares, I call it out during the night. Stops.
Oh, praise God.
So I'm doing right now as I'm learning as I go.
Oh, well, you're doing great.
The thing is, nothing left. I've been combating this thing, getting smarter than it with the power of God.
Okay, well, let's get rid of the nightmares. That's a good one. We shouldn't have to deal with that. I got rid of those 14 years ago. You can get rid of them.
It don't happen all the time anymore. It's all fizzling away. It's
oh, good.
Giving up.
Well, amen. Well, let's get rid of the last one still playing some negative dreams
right now,
in your mind.
Right now, I know when he gets nervous. There's tones in my ear. I know how he feels and how he thinks, what he's concentrating on. Right now, he's got himself wrapped around my neck right here. He's
oh, well, let's not deal with that. Let's get rid of that. Lord, thank you for Gary. Thank you that he's getting stronger and he's getting more free. Thank you that he's able to continue to minister, Lord. He's never been able to stop him, Lord. But, Lord, we're praying for these nightmares and a spirit that's trying to wrap around his neck, Lord. That's forbidden. And his foot. That's forbidden in the name of Jesus. I bind you, foul devil, touching Gary's body. I rebuke this foul spirit that plays nightmares in his mind. In the name of Jesus, we're done with your nightmares. We're done with your pain. We're done with you touching this body. I'm commanding you in Jesus' name to come out. I'm commanding you in Jesus' name to come out. Come out of there. I'm commanding you to stop tormenting Gary in any way, shape, or form. Come out of there right now. Come out of there. Come out of there right now. Stop touching his neck. Stop touching his feet. Stop playing negativity in his mind. Stop playing those dreams, devil. Come out of there in Jesus' holy name. Come out of there in Jesus' holy name. Come out of there in Jesus' holy name. Get him out, Gary. Come out of there. I'm tired of you touching me. It's all. I'm getting the complete victory. Complete victory. Complete victory in Jesus' name. Streamers, we love you. God bless you. Pray for healing on your body, streamers, in Jesus' name. Pray for your body to be healed. Be healed in Jesus' name. Amen.